And welcome to the opening ceremonies, if you want to call it that. We are here with week number two of some Valorant action. My name is Orbital. I'm joined with Go Ask Alice, who will be joining me for the first broadcast here today between Dartmouth and Springfield. Alice, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good. I'm really excited to see these games. How are you doing?
I'm doing okay. And again, we have a very fun and possibly, I almost want to say, antagonizing matchup as we, both these teams, Dartmouth and Springfield, both unfortunately lost their week one matchups. And so both of them looking for a little bit of revenge and possibly a little bit of pride. However, on possibly the worst day possible, patch day 2.03 dropped earlier this morning. I mean, that has got to be a shocker.
Yeah, the changes are a lot, too. Not only is there a really big Reyna nerf coming in, but we also see changes to three of the most three of the weapons that resolve around the eco the most. We see changes coming to the Marshall, the Stinger, and the Frenzy. Considering we've been in the Stinger and Frenzy meta for pistol round going into the early eco rounds, those are some really big changes hitting today.
Yeah, and I mean, we could even go a little bit in depth, and especially because a huge thing is these players might not have had a lot of time to practice on these. Because this drop just this morning, you are basically looking at maybe a 7-hour period where they might have been able to get one or two games in. I would be very curious if someone actually played for about 6 to 7 hours on this patch already and are now going into a competitive match. But let's go ahead and talk about it. So first, obviously the weapons, Stinger, a lot of changes to the full auto fire and the burst fire as well.
Yeah, and the price also increased, making it 1,100 rather than 1,000, which is kind of significant when you consider that the Marshall had always been the more expensive of the eco weapons. And also the nerf to the control spray as well with the burst fire, that's going to be a lot more difficult to get those kills, especially against full armored and vandaled opponents.
Yeah, not exactly the best eco that you want. Eco is hard enough, and now you're forced into a possibly lower-ended weapon. And then the Frenzy, of course. Although the Frenzy did not get any modifications with spray patterns or weapon damage, you are looking at a price increase of 400 to 500, so taking your eco to the next level and possibly forcing you into that do-or-die situation.
Yeah, because the Frenzy had been the favorite pistol for a lot of teams, considering the Ghost was an extra 100 credits. So that means you can't buy light shields and a Ghost, but now you can't buy light shields and a Frenzy. So now players are going to be forced to choose if they're going to go with the Frenzy at the sake of light shields and just buy utility instead.
Yeah, and now that we got over the weapon, something that has to be mentioned, of course. Very, very big changes coming in. Reyna. So of the two agents that were changed, Yoru and Reyna. Reyna, obviously, probably the most expansive and hardest hitting nerfs I think I've seen of any agent thus far.
Yeah, they're really brutal. Going from 4 Devour and Dismiss charges down to 2 completely changes some of the high impact Reyna plays that we've seen, especially in something like Pistol Round, where Reyna can heal herself 2 times usually the max. But now that you only have 2 charges, you're going to be so much more careful with when you're devouring and when you're dismissing in these team fights.
Yeah, and not only the charges, you're talking about the cost, right? This is a 2-pronged attack, pretty much. So taking a look, the cost of devour and dismiss charges has increased from 100 to 200, so a full 100% increase on how much it costs to simply use one of your abilities.
Yeah, and it's kind of devastating. Luckily for Reyna players, it's not all doom and gloom. Now teammates can drop orbs. You know when you're playing Reyna and you hit the enemy for 145 and you can't get the devour because your teammate gets the last bit of damage? Now you can grab the orb if you've damaged the opponent and your teammate gets the kill. So we could see some dismiss plays going off of a more team-based approach for Reyna, but still, I think the nerfs hurt her way more than that buff helps her.
Yeah, it's going to be a big change to see whether they do feel that this is the right move, which definitely influences, you know, a little bit easier team play, right? Obviously, it's not always easy to hit that last headshot or that last body shot to take that kill and basically KS your teammates. Now it's a little bit more free and expansive, so we'll see if that is the change that is needed, and maybe you won't feel those cost differences as much. However, looking at the second agent that has been changed, Yoru, this most recent agent, of course, this is the first balance change that I believe Riot is throwing out here. And so let's kind of go over that. They made changes to both the Gatecrash and Dimensional Drift in his kit.
Yeah, they made Yoru a little easier to play with your team, because as Yoru, there was a lot of information that you were gathering that your teammates couldn't see. For example, you couldn't see when you were in your ultimate, if there were enemies on the minimap, so now you can see it. The audio, it now lets you know if an enemy around you can hear the audio of Gatecrash, which allows Yoros to play a little bit safer when they're going in for that TP or for that Gatecrash. It's a little safer for them. Not a huge buff, but definitely more of a quality of life change for these Yoru players.
Yeah, gotta be a little bit happy, and at the same time, gotta kind of deal with it, because again, using Dimensional Drift as a sort of, you know, pseudo flashbang or pseudo smokescreen, not going to be allowed anymore. Looking down at some of the others, we do have a Brimstone and Phoenix change. These are more quality of life. However, if you play these agents, you might consider them a nerf, as the audio for the incendiaries on Brimstone, the Lingering Fire Zone, will be easier to hear. Same with Hot Hands from Phoenix. So, I mean, some people say that's a nerf, some people don't. I mean, do you really think it's going to be that much of an issue with these?
Yeah, it's not really that much of a problem for me. Brimstone did get massively buffed last patch, so it makes sense that they did a little bit of adjusting there. But even then, like, most of the time you can usually hear when the Molly's going down. There's only very few team fights when you have a bunch of utility being thrown out that you can't detect these Molly's. So I'm not too worried about it as for anyone who plays Brimstone or Phoenix.
Yeah, just, I'm not too worried about it, you know. I know you were talking about, you were so sad about the Reyna changes. We got in here a little bit early and you're just like, oh, this is terrible and everything. This is the one entry that I usually use. So, I mean, do you think, in your personal opinion, as a caster and as a player as well, do you think this is enough to knock her out of pretty much the top standing of agents?
Yeah, I think one of Reyna's strengths was, for me, I'm gold elo, hard stuck gold, and Reyna's flashes is awesome because you can't flash your teammates, so that's why I would play her. But now with the nerfs, like, you can get away with so much less, only 2 devour charges. I'm someone who never hits the headshot, so I'm taking half my health out at every 1v1. So now it just pushes me to play a champion like Phoenix. He has more utility, he has 2 flashes that are really strong, they can't be shot, and his ultimate is super strong right now. Only 6 ult points for Run It Back. I'm going to become a Phoenix player. I swear, Riot Games, you've changed me.
There you go. Again, taking a look at some of the agents, Phoenix sitting at a measly, 6.5% pick rate, bringing out some fun statistics, of course. But yeah, going after the targeted number one agent that a lot of people like to pick, we'll have to see how that affects the meta play. But of course, we understand the pub stomp games that you play are not as coordinated, we should say, as some of the competitive games that we will hopefully see here today. Again, Dartmouth and Springfield, both of them coming into play. So first map, we do know which maps will be played. First map will be Ascent, with Springfield College on attacking first and Dartmouth on defensive. Second will be Bind with the sides flipped. And then Haven, of course, will be the final. So 3 fairly standard maps, nothing crazy. Of course, Icebox not coming in because I don't think anyone really likes that map.
Yeah, poor Icebox. I love seeing teams play Icebox because I think it's so interesting seeing how the meta is evolving because no one plays it a lot, but most teams just ban it out. They don't want to deal with it. Rather go for a safer pick like Ascent. It's going to be interesting seeing how Ascent goes with the Marshall changes because they did buff the Marshall as well. We didn't really talk about it, but they made the Marshall cheaper and the zoom speed faster. So on a map like Ascent and even Haven to an extent where Ops are really good on the maps because of the really long angles, I wonder if we're going to see more Marshals than Stingers? Maybe I'm overly optimistic for our sniper friends.
One can only hope, and of course, we love to see the snipers come out. I personally love kind of the skill that came from it. You only have 1 bullet until you have about a 3-second reload, maybe 1.5 if I'm counting correctly. But I feel it's always better than the Spray and Pray. Then again, I was always a P90 fan in CSGO because I couldn't aim. So that's a whole different story there. But let's talk about it, right? Again, attacking and defense, this is all that is really here right now. You know, there is no hostage situations or anything like that. All planting, all of that stuff. And considering both these teams went 0-2, I don't think we had any recaps. And unfortunately, we weren't able to really see how they lost in those matches. But taking a look here, when a team goes 0-2, what do you surmise about their playstyle? Is there anything that you can kind of glean from them? Or is it pretty much just standard? Possibly they just got smashed or possibly just had an unfortunate day.
Yeah, it's difficult to tell exactly what was happening without watching the matches when a team does go 0-2. Something it does tell us is that they have a little bit more difficulty adapting to their enemy's playstyle than some other teams. Because if you're losing 2-1, that means most of the time you're taking the first or the second map off. So you either have the ability to, one of the teams in a 2v1 has the ability to overcome their loss and kind of reset their mental. Because once you lose the first game, it can be really hard to get into the proper mental for the second one. So it'll be interesting to see if whoever wins the first map tonight is going to be indicative of who's going to take the series.
Oh, okay. So really, it's are you mentally prepared for this matchup? Not so much, hey, skill-wise and all that stuff. It might be the changes. And of course, we have seen some very close maps. A lot of the, I believe, stream games that we've been able to see over week one and week two have been a fantastic sets of going very close to 11-11 or 11-13 and all that stuff. So looking at these, do you expect to see some of those kind of close matches, or do you assume this is going to be a wash one way or another?
I really hope we see some close matches tonight. It is important to note that Dartmouth has already lost a match against Springfield College in the preseason, so there's going to be a little bit of animosity there, so we'll see if they can get a comeback. I really want to see some life out of Dartmouth, though. I want to see them get their first map win of the regular season, but I do want to see Springfield put up a fight, so I'm really hoping for a close series, though I'm not sure about my expectations at this point.
Okay. And once again, we were talking about how both these teams are playing here in the Emergence League. Now, later on in the day, we will also have Florida Atlantic versus UBC Okanagan, I believe, from the Champions Division. And then at 9 p.m. EST, we have Sacramento State Gold versus Midland. And then at 11 p.m. all the way late at night in the EST time zone, we have Sacramento State Green and Boise State 2. So, fantastic teams lined all the way up, but we don't get to talk about that anymore as we are finally hopping into Ascent, loading in with some of these players. Once again, it will be Springfield College on the attacking side first and Dartmouth College on the defensive. So, in just a few moments, we will take a look, see what agents are being selected first. And, of course, Scuba looking like he wants to immediately hop on that jet play.
Yeah, I'm excited to see some jet plays coming out, especially on Ascent. The long angles, jet mains love it. You have the operator plays. You have all of the opportunities to get the double updraft kills. I'm super excited to see some jet action tonight.
It's always been like, I always feel it's one of those standards, right? Going back to the days of pre-alpha and all that, Wardell, watching Wardell on some of these massive jet plays, just throwing out the knives, being able to cut down his opponents very, very quickly. However, it's a very quick switch. We do see some swaps out. Looks like we have a Cypher, an Omen, and looks like a Viper coming out. And unfortunately, only one jet. Very sadly, one jet to go over on the defending side that will be taken by Amian.
Yeah, one jet is kind of an interesting difference, especially with switching from the Viper to the jet, a dramatically different playstyle. I am excited to see Viper on Ascent. There are some really cool Viper lineups you can get with her Viper wall, so it'll be interesting to see how they utilize this.
We'll have to wait and see. Again, we do have Altoven rocking some fancy gadgets, of course, showing off that, yeah, I probably play this agent a lot. But again, surprisingly, on the attacking side, we do have Reyna still. So yeah. Where do you think we're going to feel most of this pain? Because again, it looks like this is a standard. Hey, we're just going to play what's comfortable. This is how we want to play it.
Yeah, I'm interested to see if Aggressive Act, how they can adapt to the differences in Reyna's kit. I don't know how much practice they've been able to get on the Reyna, so it'll be interesting to see how they utilize their Devour and Dismiss in these teamfights.
Oh, it looks like first round.
Sorry there. It looks like we have some action coming into A main. The Dark Cover is coming out to kind of slow their push, but we do see the Raze Boombot pressuring just a little bit while Cypher is lurking up into Cat here. See if the Omen is going to push him or if they're going to push themselves into this Omen player. The flash doesn't land.
Oh.
Aggressive Act showing us we didn't need to worry that much about the Reyna with a headshot onto Bruce. But a quick trade from Amian onto SE Tiki means it's Dusk Cell gets the trade. It is now a 4v3 on the attacker side.
Yep, Springfield deciding they don't want to take any chances. Very quick force and plant and already... catching a few members unawares, that already kind of signals a lapse in judgment, which I'm very worried about, right? You never want to be caught sleeping that easily, so possibly spells a little bit of difficulty for Dartmouth during this entire series.
Yeah, this is a 2v4 retake, which is super difficult. Minnesota does get taken out by Scuba, making this a 4v1 with Altoven, the last member left alive, trying to make something happen, but Jellies gets the frag, and that's four players left alive on this attacker side. Not a great way to start if you're the defenders.
Yeah, and there are some things that can obviously be said, but what worries me the most is right off the bat, you see a lot of standing still whenever a lot of this is going on. I don't like to nitpick a lot of micro mechanics because personally, I'm terrible at micro mechanics. Any game I play, I am terrible, so I'm a strategist. One strategy that you want to take to not die as quickly, don't stand still in the face of any opponent. So a little bit worried about this, and hopefully we see a little bit more action, maybe a little bit more drifting side to side whenever this occurs, and just being more aware of where your opponents could possibly be.
Yeah, definitely. Looks like we are going to have two Stingers and three Spectres on the side of Springfield, and they are going to get the first frag with that onto Bruce. That means it's a 5v4 already for the attackers, and Jellies makes that a 5v3 as I'm speaking, as they push their way onto A site again.
If the name broke, don't fix it. You take two, lots of health bars. Omen deciding that, hey, I don't want to live anymore, and Minnesota takes that one, but still. Fast takes means fast gameplay, and I'm liking this from Springfield College.
Ooh, beautiful headshot by Kenster there into Zuskel, making this a 3v3. It is now winnable. Phoenix does have the Stinger. Even with the nerfs, it's still proving to be really effective here as Minnesota tries to get some action here, but looks like he's going to get taken out by Main, making it a 3v1 for Kenster. We'll see if he can do anything with the Stinger here.
Oh, and this is... that's not fun. You can't really save in this sort of situation. Because, again, you don't really have anything to save. So, there you go. Scuba grabs that one. And, again, rough time starting out here. And the way I always see it is in any eco situation, it will always feel bad the next round. There's no two ways about it. You will almost always end up feeling bad. Now we're seeing a decent buy come out. You know, full guns. So, this is where I hope to see the side of Dartmouth start to come back, start to get a couple kills on the board, start building up their own eco as multiple of them are all sitting at zero.
Yeah, it looks like there is going to be a bonus coming out from Springfield, which will be helpful for Dartmouth to get their first round on the board, but it looks like there's going to be another slow creep onto Ava. Amian takes out Jelly, making it a 5v4 and a really good pick on the defender side.
Yeah, little picks, and I mean, you're running three subs and a silence versus a full round buy. I feel that's a little sloppy coming out of the side of Springfield. I mean, you do want to get all the advantages, but again, don't spend too much. You're still sitting on 3 to 4 K each, so you can afford to lose just one round.
Yeah, and Kinster gets Dust Cell in the Cypher Cam. Now it's a 5v3 for Springfield College. I'm not sure exactly what they're trying to do. It looks like they're going to try to pressure B, but they're going to run into all of Killjoy's utility. But as I say that, Tiki gets the frag onto Kinster with the Spectre, which evens it out just a little bit more for Springfield.
Yeah, I don't think Springfield have any issues with losing this round. They literally haven't really bought. So any kills that they get is pretty much siphoning more creds out of the pockets of Dartmouth. So they're okay just taking a couple trades. And again, dropping down to 30 seconds, I don't think they have too many worries. But still, don't slow play too much. Give an inch, the other team might take a mile.
Yeah, they are going to run out of time here, especially when they have to run through all this Killjoy utility. It looks like we're going to get a Rainaleer out as Aggressive Act clears twice onto site. Doesn't get destroyed, but Scuba gets the kill into Altoven, but Minnesota quickly trades it back. It's now a 3v2. This is now winnable for Springfield. Yeah. Chet sneaks her way onto site. Oh. But Aggressive Act with the headshot onto Minnesota. It's now a 2v1 for Scuba.
Oh, he got the plant, so the gold's still going to go through, but he's walking around pretty loudly.
And Amian takes him out with a 3k. Nice little three piece from the Jet, and really well played by Dartmouth getting their first round on the board.
Yeah, but this is also going to be the first time that we see a full buy out of Springfield as well. So if this is full buy versus full buy, I'm very interested to see, because again, running subs against a full buy of weapons, always, yeah, immediately, full armor, everything's up, and they still have at least 2k each to spare. That means that these next two rounds are going to hit, this round and next will be full buys no matter what. So again, a little bit of difficulty for Dartmouth to keep crawling up.
Yeah, and Dartmouth's going to be on some type of partial by two. We see some light shields going out, a bulldog, not exactly what you want to see if you're the defenders on this side.
And a quiet start. I preferably really liked watching Springfield run a fast, you know, fast take, fast run. But again, feeling out the opposition and seeing how B might work, they know A will work, and that's already been kind of countered. So taking it slow is fine. Just don't let the time run down too long.
Yeah, and aggressive act is getting some control of this B main, but there is gonna be Killjoy utility waiting for them on the other side, and Dartmouth is playing pretty heavily onto this B site with the Phoenix kind of lurking near market area, so it's gonna be a pretty hard take if they want to go with this super quickly.
And they're actually rotating out, so I really dislike this choice by them at this point. If you're going to go in, you need to do it, I feel, or start making a move at about 55 to a minute. And if you're just waiting, give them more time to rotate.
Yeah, aggressive act making their way onto site, gets spotted by the Killjoy bot, but they do make it, they do kill it, but Raze is gonna ult with the showstopper and gets the kill in Minnesota. It's now a 5v3, make that a 4v3 on the side of the attackers. So now Dartmouth is gonna be playing retake again in this match.
Yeah, and that's what you want. You wanna be aggressive, you wanna be assertive, and be able to properly set yourselves up. That is why you give yourselves just a little bit extra time to really clear out your bases and make sure to set up and get ready for this retake. Last
player standing. Oh, last one alive on the side of Dartmouth, a jet and a dream. Does get paranoid to get the slow, but does get the frag onto Duskcell, making this a 2v1, make that a 1v1. Duskcell has the opportunity, has jet knives, double up drops up, does not find the Viper who's waiting on lane, checks boathouse, the Viper's not there. I don't know if he's gonna find him in time.
Oh, shot in the leg. I think that's the unfortunate scenario. You know, you leave a little bit of your body out from undercover and you get taken out. But again, Amiens so far has shown that that he is ready to go on this jet and ready to start taking control. 7-3 so far. Unfortunately, expended the ultimate for no use. So gonna have to wait for that one to come back up.
Yeah, really well played by Scuba there to kind of lurk onto the lane. The double updraft up from the jet players is always so scary, especially when they have knives, because you have no idea what angle they're coming from. But really well played by Scuba to kind of hide behind the architecture of the bombsite.
Yeah, and the jump around wasn't bad either. So I want to see a little bit more of that coordination. However, my biggest concern is, again, they are not hitting a lot of their shots. They need to be a little bit more aware of that and prepare, right? How do you prepare? Maybe shorten the range that you're engaging some of these fights. If you're not taking the long range fights, go ahead and move up. Try some of those risky firefights in the face of Springfield. And maybe at that point, Dartmouth will have a bit easier time, right? I know that's hard to say on a defender's side, but you got to figure out how to change those advantages to your own accord.
Yeah, and you also see a lot of utility being used really early on the side of Dartmouth. The Paranoia comes out, and they don't get anything for it besides a really slow rotate out, and that's a really big piece of utility, especially with the price increase. It's 400 credits, and they didn't get anything from it.
A little bit of a running back being used, so King Star to help.
He didn't get anything. Just gets taken out by the Reyna. Did play a little bit for info. They now have a good idea about where the attackers are here. Let's see if they can do anything to rotate off that information, but they're gonna kind of just give up mid for free. And as I say it, the Sova ult comes out, tags one, gets the kill on his Scuba, making it a 5v4. And again, Springfield's kind of running out of time here, but it looks like they're gonna get this bombsite unless Killjoy can slow them down.
I mean, they're still in the middle, and that's gonna be a zip all the way to back. You can see on your mini map right now, planning on the B, and he gets a kill as well. So Jelly's is happy about this setup. A couple seconds left, and that's plenty of time, as aggressive is his namesake. Gonna be able to pick it up, but a nice little peek over the wall is gonna secure a second. So 2-on-3 here with defenders trying to make the way in.
Last one alive. Jelly's on this site, gets the first frag, does not get the second, and really well played by Dartmouth, but that was a beautiful ultimate from Jellies there. The ult B site gets the kill and the plant. I thought that round was gonna go the way of Springfield there.
Yeah, and that's also a little bit of a difference right there. When you're pinched for a time like that, you're dropping down 30 seconds. As I stated before, you don't want to allow that to happen. When that happens, you are forced into high-pressure situations. You can't execute these long macro movements that you're hoping for, and you have to decide kind of quickly how it's going to work. right? You have a decision, run straight in, and that's about all you have. You can't really clear your corners a whole lot, and you can't wait around, right? There was a little peek over one of the top walls. I think it was one of the gates, and that was just very well played by the side of Dartmouth to read on that, right? They are scattered, they're disoriented, and we have our opportunity there.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Springfield taking a really long time to make their way into these sites. They're not pushing until they have like 25 seconds left on the clock, and that's not a lot of time to clear your corners. Early paranoia again coming out on the side of Dartmouth. Doesn't get much for it.
Yeah, gotta use utility early, and they at least spot one.
Springfield making their way onto this bomb site. Viper ult coming out, but Omian getting one frag already onto Tiki, making it a 4v5. Luckily, the Viper ult's gonna protect the rest of their team. They are on a kind of half buy here.
Half buy, but Omian still saying I'm oh my gosh, the spray through is grabbing so many.
Oh, nice Cypher ult coming out, getting locations of them to play around this Viper ult, but Omian with a 3k takes out Scoob. It's now a 4v2. Bomb is ticking down, and Dusk Cell takes out Omni, and this is now a 2v1. Goes under heavy, but Minnesota clutches it out, getting the frag onto Omen, and that's the third round going on the side of Dartmouth.
Omni and straight up beasting right now. The player to watch, 11-4. And honestly, that A-site hold was what made that play. That both worries me and gets mad respect for me at the same time. Holding down three members, making sure they wait outside the room. Not allowing them in, and then having Dartmouth slowly rotate around. Honestly, that rotate by his teammates was a little bit slow, but I think it was the correct call. You're not sure if they're trying to fake plant as well. But still, holding out three, getting three, and I think that last firefight as well, is slowly keeping Dartmouth in this game. And the only reason I say that is that's a lot of pressure for one player to hold. So a little bit worried about how it keeps going moving forward. But let's hope he can keep it up.
Yeah, and we see if we're going to have a glass operator coming out of this side of Dartmouth here, holding this cat angle, but the Viper Ball is going to go up, denying him vision, and now he's going to force a retreat off the angle, so now it's going to be interesting to see where this operator plays on the side of the Omen.
Slow movements once again, and straight through mid. Not exactly liking this. The last time they did this, they dropped down to about 30 seconds and got pinched really hard. So if this occurs again, I have a feeling Springfield might be struggling pretty hard, but looks like it's working a little bit better.
Yeah, the smoke goes down right as Aggressive Act peaks, and they are able to manage to get the headshot onto the Phoenix, making it a 5v4. Killjoy's still on this site, though, and Springfield's rotating all the way around from mid into B main, but they do leave the Omen lurking behind, seeing if he can get a pick or not.
Yeah, I always love the lurker role. It's one of my favorites, mostly because you don't play with the team. And you get the free picks sometimes, you know, it looks good on the KDA. At the same time, it can sometimes look pretty weak. So we'll see if they can keep it up and if he is able to pick any extra kills.
Yeah, really beautiful Nano Swarm kind of slowing down the push, giving Dartmouth enough time to rotate onto this site, though it looks like they are going to wait for retake, but Minnesota gets the frag onto Aggressive Act. He does get traded out by Tiki, making it a 4v3. Omen ulti coming out, and Altovin with a kill onto TK. It's now a 3v2, and Omen is going to be late for this retake, and
10 seconds left. Yeah, they're able to get the spike down. I think they're good. 2v3.
Oh, Omian with a kill and a dust cell, making this a 2v1, even though the Omen is going to be so late to this take. The lone Viper left on the bomb site, 30 HP on Omian. Let's see if he can do anything. He has to wait out this Molly.
It's not bad to wait in a round. Remember, you don't have to go out. They have to come to you no matter what, so here's a chance.
Misses the shot, and Bruce gets the kill on the Scuba. That was such a weird round. I don't know if you noticed, but Dartmouth had started rotating off onto A while Viper was already on the site beginning their plant. So despite being really late to that retake, they're able to clutch it out. Really well played by Dartmouth here.
Yeah, and that's capitalizing, I think, on a little bit of the slowness of Springfield right now. You can see they slowed down their tempo, which I agree and disagree with. Slowing down the tempo is good, but that's only if you're opting for some fast rounds in between. Tempo shifting and tempo changing within the game itself is crucial to continuously offset your opponent, right? If you do two slow rounds, throw a fast round in there, or maybe every three or four, and that means that your opponent might be a little bit complacent and you catch them a little bit off guard. I think this might be the chance that they're looking for, though, a little bit of a potential fast, but they're leaving the spike behind, so I guess they're waiting around. I I can't agree with that too much.
Yeah, they're playing for picks, but they're going to peek into an operator if they're not careful. If they dry pick this England to main, they're going to have a rough time. Boombot goes out.
Three kills
coming out of Bruce with a slow peek around B main. A main, that is devastating. That is devastating.
Oh, this is why you don't play the slow game. Oh, the op is too strong. Straight through the head, into the body of another. You take two. A third shot as well, even though they tried to salvage it, just means this round is pretty much over for the side of Springfield.
Yeah, I don't know what else they can do there. The 3K from the operator player on the side of Dartmouth was so clean. Looks like they're going to try to get something coming through Cat here. We'll see if Jellies will be able to swing on this silver or not. Valadron is going to come out and reveal their location. But as they say that, Jellies gets the 2K. It's now a winnable round on the side of Springfield. This is a 3v2 and the bomb is going down. But Amien gets the trade onto Dusk Cell, making this a 3v1. Jellies on the bomb site. Knows where the jet is, gets the headshot, 3k from Jellies themselves, now a 2v1. This is winnable for either side unless Dartmouth starts playing together here.
That's what they're hoping for at least, and take a look, it is going to be a Killjoy ultimate coming out. That's a little worrisome.
Yeah, the lockdown coming out means that Tobin does not have a lot of time. Doesn't get the spray transfer, Altobin gets the kill on the Jellies, and you know, you is a Dartmouth you expect to win that round, but I got really close for comfort for them.
You do expect it to, but no matter what, and especially from what we've seen so far, there's it's very much whoever has the main advantage whenever this spike goes down is going to have, I think, that clutch win. A lot of those early kind of missteps where you're allowing your opponent to step too close to you, allowing your opponent to get very free shots off, has kind of been nullified. You can see it now, a lot of them moving very quickly, efficiently, and landing their shots. I don't think we're going to see any freebies anymore, so I very much enjoy seeing this level of play now coming out of both these teams.
Yeah, and they, unfortunately for Springfield, they are on a save with Sheriffs and Stingers only. I wonder if they're going to try to make some type of quick push, but as you've been saying, they've been really slow on their executes, and they've been giving Dartmouth so much time to rotate onto the site.
Not just rotate, it's the setup and prep, right? A huge thing is, if the prep goes down, you're a little bit worried, but this might be the fast.
Ooh. Dry peek through the smoke. Kenster punishes Dust Self from that, making this a 5v4. A bit harder for Springfield to get on the site. The leader does go out, but Altobin with the headshot on the scuba makes it a 5v3. Makes that a 5v2. It's just open season and flawless round coming out of Dartmouth here.
Very well done. From the start, losing two rounds off and then going on a 5-round win streak. I talked a little bit bad about them, but they have definitely come back with the mental, with the plays, and, you know, that operator play, I think, gave Bruce the kick in the butt that he needed. The confidence booster was huge, and, you know, in that particular situation, you know the comps are popping, just so happy about getting those three right off the bat, loving this play so far.
Yeah, just a really poor execute on the side of Springfield there. They just dry peeked the smoke. They had two Rainaliers out, but they just didn't use them, and they get really heavily punished for it.
Yeah, and this is going to happen continuously if they don't start kind of stacking properly. Once you use a lot of those utility items, you need to push. You need to be aggressive and be able to make your way in. This slow round, it's already been accustomed to, right? You can see it. Dartmouth are ready for it, this slow peek and push, and yeah, this is going to happen every single time.
Yeah, I mean, just holding the angle, and they just, you're right, they do just slow peek it, not even a wide swing, they get punished for it. Ooh, the Sova ult coming out, stopping the plant, and getting the kill on a scoop, but making it a 5v3 for Dartmouth here. Oh, bomb is still gonna go down on this A side, it's gonna be really difficult for them to hold. Bruce says, no plant gold for you today, 2v5 coming out, spring through the wall. Reyna's able to get a kill here, she could heal out.
They're right on the walls of each other. Good line.
Minnesota gets a shock dart kill and an aggressive act, making it a 5v1 for Jellies, and doesn't take anyone out with them. That's the second flawless round coming out of Dartmouth here.
Not just second flawless, it's the second in a row, right? And that was on a full buy as well, or an attempted full buy. Now we have a 6-round catastrophe. massive, I want to say, losers buyback or losers help right there coming out, because they get their second one as well. But still, I'm seeing a lot of slow play for very, very low reasons, right? At this point, you know the team's going to rotate if you don't push one of the sites. It's very obvious once they start peeking, you can tell everyone's there. You have to switch up your style. You have to switch up whatever the tactics you are using right now. If you are Springfield College, you have to realize you have been read, you have been seen through. Figure out a new course of action.
Yeah, you're totally right here. And it looks like we're getting another really slow play on to A, but the operator is still in the hands of Bruce here on the side of Dartmouth, so hopefully they learn their lessons and they flash out of this A main, or else they're gonna have a hard time taking the site.
Ooh. First operator shot misses. No 2K in a row this time, so a little bit of a change.
Lear comes out, but Bruce still gets the kill on a scuba. It's the second one. It's a 5v2, and Bruce is just impenetrable with the 3K. Stop peeking this man. He is feeling himself on his operator.
Third flawless in a row. Bruce holding that trophy high. I think that's the third 3K he's had thus far. And, you know, for all the bashing I've done on both sides, I have to say, Dartmouth have shown excellence when it comes to the defensive rounds. I understand that this map is slightly defender-sided, I feel. A lot of good peeking angles for the operator. If you can hang on to that, you get a lot of good value out of it. And so thus far, haven't come back after dropping two rounds in three. Two at the beginning and then third in the fourth. They've done very well to secure a very nice round lead for themselves going into the second half.
Yeah, and the three flawless rounds in a row, they're going to have to pull something out if you're Springfield here. You're going to have to try something new like you've been continuously saying. The Reyna ult comes out. Looks like they're going to Lear onto the site. Two Lears coming out. Let's see if this Reyna can get the entry frag here. The Showstopper coming out. Should be a couple of kills. Kills it, run it back from the defenders, and they made their way pretty cleanly onto this bomb site. But Minnesota, is that probably his third shock dart kill of this match already? Whew, excellent hold from Minnesota there, but does get taken out by Jelly. The aggressive axe gets the reset on Empress with a frag on a Kinstar, making this a 4v3. Viper ult does go down? Is it still up? No, they lose the Viper ult, even though Scuba didn't die.
That's a little rough, but Jet deciding that it's time to end this all.
Oh. It's a headshot onto aggressive act. The updraft doesn't get him a lot of info here. Does get tagged by the tripwire, but still gets the kill onto Jellies with the knife. Think that a 3K, so 1v3, and Altoven cleans it up. Beautiful 3K coming on the side of Amin here. Whew. What a half.
Beautiful half indeed, but I like what I saw in that last round. That's exactly what Springfield needs to do. Tempo shift, they got the plant, and you have to realize some of these things. These teams, both these teams, definitely do not feel comfortable whenever a take is happening, right? You see them give quite a bit, even though they lose one. Hey, we need to back up, we need to relent, and I think that's exactly what needs to happen. Take your time, but at the same time, understand the nuances of the team. So this time around, it is Springfield on the defensive, and I want to see Dartmouth playing more aggressively, using that tempo shift, and maybe rushing every so often, right? If you continue to play slow, they saw exactly what happened and they were able to abuse it. Don't let the opponent do that to you.
Yeah, you have to wonder if the defense side is going to go better for Springfield. It seems to suit their playstyle just a little bit more of playing a little more passively and waiting for these over-aggressive pushes. So let's see if they can get something down here as they try to hold this site. Amin is going to peek out and gets headshot by Aggressive Axe. So now it's already a disadvantage coming out of Springfield. A really nice frag from Aggressive Axe starting off our round.
Yep, gotta love the pistol rounds. I love seeing some of these. Some teams have, you know, the very nice gentleman's agreement of just rush at each other and good luck. But this one's a little bit more calculated.
Yeah, not a lot of frenzies coming in after the nurse. You see a lot of classics and light shield. You have a couple ghosts here and there, but it may explain why this pistol round's a little less chaotic than we normally see.
Just a little couple pre-fires going through. So I like seeing that. Just a little, hi Bob, hi Bill.
Shelly gets caught with his paranoia in his hand, but doesn't get punished for it. Gets some damage onto the Killjoy, gets the first kill onto Sova, and they get the second onto Killjoy. And really well done from Springfield with the flank there.
Yeah. Again, you know, that's exactly what you don't want to happen. at this point, I think both teams have realized that when attacking, both teams do not excel at making good decisions on the fly. Or I wouldn't say good at decisions, efficient decisions, right? Make a call, go for it, stick with it, don't hesitate. Because at that point, that's exactly what happens. You stall out, you get caught in a choke point, and you panic. That was a panic play coming out of the side of Dartmouth, where they're not sure if they want to push in, don't want to worry about getting shot there, or if they want to push back, try and deal with the target that's just coming back. So be aggressive, be efficient, and just follow the call like this. And unfortunately, that didn't work.
Tommy and dashes into a Bucky headshot from Viper. Scuba gets the 2K, does get traded out by Altoven. Doesn't matter if Dustcell gets another two frags with the Stinger and aggressive act is going to close that out in a pretty solid win from Springfield there. You expect them to win. They did do a kind of a force buy. They had Stingers and Bucky, so you don't expect to win that if you're Dartmouth, but still kind of depressing.
Yeah, now full Vandals coming out, I believe. That's three Vandals and a couple extras. And on the flip side, still the Shoddy's coming out. So attacking side finally up and about them, and I want to see what they can do with this buy round. This is the time to start turning it around. Get those last three, three rounds that they need to win. Very, very often that about four or five.
Yeah, Minnesota's going to peek cat here. The dark cover is going to come out, and they're just going to be able to kind of creep up mid. Let's see what Springfield can do here. Jelly's holding it down with this Bulldog. Doesn't quite get a kill. Got a TP to safety there. A little shadow step.
Said, nope, I'm out. You have a better gun. I don't want to deal with that. And a full split, hoping to catch someone lurking on the edge. So this is another way that you can deal with some of the opponents that like to flank in slow plays like this. So if this works, not a terrible.
Oh man, getting the kill onto Jellies as they were distracted by the Owl Drone. And that's why Sova is so strong on a map like Ascent. You're able to get so much info. And then if your duelist can just play off the info you're gathering, it makes the rounds much easier on this attacking side.
Duo is working well, but they're walking straight through a little bit of a choke point. Let's see if they can play this through. Lots of balls going up.
Yeah, the Viper and the Cypher makes it a kind of a difficult site to push onto unless they go quickly and are able to take out this Cypher. Camera does see them coming into cat. Scuba with the angle there, gets Minnesota. Now it's a 3 kills on the side of the defenders, but they do get traded out. So now it's a 3v2 for the attackers, my bad. And let's see if this plant's going down. They do get it down. Kinstar,
oh,
the last member left alive, does take out Tiki with the better gun, but Dustcell punishes him for reloading in the middle of a cat. And that's going to be another round going on to Springfield's side.
Yeah, that's the age old cut with your pants down. Unfortunately, he gets shot. Reloading, using all the abilities, and a good attempt, I would say, from the side of Dartmouth. They were able to collapse in, get the plant, and again, I say if a round is going to the plant, if you're able to get a plant anywhere, I think that's a good sign of progress, right? No matter what, instead of those flawless rounds, or instead of those full punishes without a plant, that's progress. You are able to make your way in. You're able to kind of read through your opponents and start getting some pressure down. The more they can do that, the more that they can be decisive and start building up those credits and possibly start finding kills of their own in angles that Springfield might not assume.
Oh, the first kill from Bruce with the new Marshall buff coming out takes out Jelly, making it a 5v4 on the favor of the attackers.
This man's nasty with that scope.
Owl Drone is going to come out again. Let's see if they can get anything for it.
Swap out to the Vandal. Amian, this one. We've been watching him play the entire time. I'm excited. Ooh, good call right there. And hopefully we can see a few more picks. They're looking to try and work these angles just a bit more. Maybe even it up before they push.
Yeah, Aggressive Act is going to fall back and going to give up Min, making it... they're going to provide more support onto this B side, meaning that... Now the attackers have all of mid control, which gives them the options to push through spawn or to push onto this B site right now.
We do see a LMG coming out for Tiki, which I love. There it is.
Spray through the wall. Doesn't quite get one, but Aggressive Act. So two kills on the side of the defenders, making it a 2v4 as Dustcell gets his second frag in Minnesota. Gonna try to work their way onto the site. Not much he can do here. Gets sprayed down by the Odin.
never bring Never bring a regular gun to a god fight, apparently. That's just rude. That's like 100, 150 round mag. You don't aim. You just spray and literally pray to the gods to hit. But so far, both these teams showing that they can play the defense perfectly. The problem is getting those wins, of course, because that leads into a very scary situation where pretty much you win two rounds on the attacking side and you're good to go for the defense. So if this is true, it is a worrying trend for the next two maps.
Yeah, let's see what Dartmouth can do here. They're kind of creeping up A, but the Viper ult is going to scare them away. They're going to say, I don't want any part of that. They're going to rotate out super quickly, but there is a lurker on the defensive side. Let's see if he can catch anyone out here. They're just kind of sprinting with their knives out, but it looks like Jelly's not going to actually contest it. Unless...
I mean, they're all five stacking on this B side, and if that Omen... Jellies, he's been one to watch for the lurking plays. If he pulls this off, that's just rude.
Oh, that's going to be so devastating for the attackers if he gets this kill. Is Killjoy's going to slow peek? Jellies, I wonder if they're going to look. Like, really
passive. I think he feels it. He definitely feels it there.
That's a 2K. Shadow steps out, but right into Avian's crosshair. That's now a 4v3. Not totally devastating, but you do hate to see that. Aggressive Axe getting the trade kill onto Ami, and it's now a 4v2 for the attackers, and really that lurk from Jellies there kind of saved them the round here.
Yeah, trigger control is always a big thing, you know. Don't want to shoot too early because you might catch a few more in the crosshairs, and I love this. So now forced into an unfortunate scenario. Very nice jump and fire by the Sova, but we'll see if they can even collapse in. Ooh.
Bruce gets the first pick, and Omen ulti is up. Let's see if he's going to use it. He's going to transfer the spike. He only has 13 seconds, so he has to go now if he wants to get enough time to get this plant down.
Looks like they're going to save. They do have an op and a Vandal, so I think that's the right call. You have an op. You were able to pick one, and yeah, round's kind of lost, but this is where you got to start being a little bit worried. Now Springfield have caught up. Right? This is now Springfield's time to play. And remember, you're sitting on very low eco. So you can see a little bit of an unfortunate buy scenario here. One SMG coming out of Keenstar, or Kenster, I believe is how he pronounces it. And a full set of Vandals plus an Odin on the other side with two ultimates available, right? This is not the scenario you want to be playing against.
Yeah, and we're going to have to see
something.
Then
again, you have four on the other. Oops.
True. Yeah, no, you're going to have to see something different coming out of the side of Dartmouth here. If they want to take a round on this T side, it's been really hard for them to get onto these sites.
Yeah, and again, just a slow play from the attacking side. This is the way to cut it out. That's the way. Run it back. See if you can find anyone. Make a play.
Peeks through. The Viper passes right through on the Dark Cloud party. Not going to know he's there at all. Luckily, they don't get too punished for it, but I wonder if they're going to hold that angle still. Ooh, doesn't quite get the... Frag, but Minnesota gets the first kill in the dust cell, but the Showstopper comes out, taking him two kills there, making it a 2v4 for the attackers, and Dartmouth sprayed down by the Odin, the 3k coming on the side of Tiki, and they're smoked out in main. Omen is gonna ulti, but I think they're already on the bomb. If they're not, they're gonna be soon. The Molly comes out, and Kenster gets the first kill in the Tiki, but now it's a 3v1, and Bruce is gonna have to save here.
Yeah, gonna have to save. Defuse went through and it was looking oh so good. They got the defuse, but they got the plant, but unfortunately the retake was very, very good. And again, this is very rough goings, right? At some point, the constant pressure coming out is always gonna hammer down on you. This constant barrage of bullets, and it really sways your judgment, so I can't fault the side of Springfield, not Springfield, of Dartmouth having trouble here closing out a few of the winner side, because even if you get a full wipe, even if you get that round win, you plant the spike and you're able to make it happen, you still have to fight through about two full rounds of weapons, right? Yeah. That is the problem.
And not even a full buy coming out instead of Dartmouth. It's going to make this really hard unless Bruce can get the pick here, but it doesn't look like anyone's too inclined to peek in mid. A little bit of damage coming out.
I think that was a
little
ulti coming out too.
Yeah, Sovic tags the raise with the Odin, doesn't quite get the kill.
Might try a little bit more. Jelly's definitely sniffed something. He's been very on point of finding these little slow plays and catching at least one or two kills. So really, like, he saw the gun peek.
Jelly, see if they can get anything here. Doesn't get the headshot, and they're just so close. The Aladrone does spot him out. He's gonna Shadow step out back into market. And then Marie Shadow steps in the Paranoid and the headshot on Ami, and he's looking the wrong way. Minnesota does trade him out. However, that's a beautiful Omen play.
Gotta love it, but there's gonna be the big one. Point blank.
Pinsler saved by his operator player. It's now a 3v3. Let's see if Dartmouth can get the bomb down, but Dustel takes out Altoven, who had the spike, so now it's a 3v2. Cypher ulti coming out. Curveball does flash, and he's able to safely get the spike, but there's like 25 seconds left on the clock, so Dartmouth is going to have to do something pretty soon here.
Yeah, just a couple seconds left, and again, spike is running out. This is exactly what happened last time, and running straight towards A. I don't think he's going to get there in time, unless he just hard sprints. If he hard sprints, he might be able to make it, but he has already spotted.
It's cam darted. There is a Viper player in heaven, runs into the Cypher trip. Oh, so unfortunate for Bruce there. Loses the operator for his troubles as well. And now advantage goes to Springfield here as they've really stepped up in this defense side.
Yeah, let's see if they can do the run. I think they're actually going to pull it off. They're sitting at 7 rounds, I believe, of a win. And that's actually close to matching the 8 that Dartmouth went on before the round swap. So if they can continue this, they can probably bleed Dartmouth out of the last two rounds, because this is another full buy. You see the weapons coming out for Dartmouth. If they lose this one, they will probably have to eco on the back end. So not looking pretty for Dartmouth and their prospective chances.
Yeah, really rough goings on this T side for Dartmouth. Let's see if he can get the pick onto Cypher. Doesn't quite land the shots. That would have been a huge opening for Dartmouth. But now the Viper Wall's up. The Cypher utility is still there. Cypher Molly gonna slow it down with the toxins. And they just stalled out again in this A main.
I mean, I know there's so many options, but this has already proved not a viable option. And I mean, they're sitting 30 to 40 seconds on this side with a lurker on the back, and I mean, this is it. Good luck.
Yeah, Aladrone goes out. We have the Phoenix Wall. Curveball does go out. The Aladrone is going to find Cypher in heaven as Dartmouth makes their way onto the bomb side. A lot of utility coming out on both sides. No picks yet. Everyone is still alive. It's going to be a 5v5 retake coming on this side. Springfield, the Altova makes that a 4v5. Spray through the smoke. Doesn't find a second one for his troubles.
Loving this play. Just push in, get it down, force the defenders to come to you. And Kenster, there you go, looking to tag a few. Maybe he can get a few kills on the back end.
Yeah, a lot of really good post plant positions coming out here, but Scuba does get the kill on the Kenster, opening up this site for the defenders to retake. Another leader comes out, Altoven, with the kill on the Scuba, makes this a 4v3, but they are running out of time. Miss Refill wants to do anything, but Minnesota gets the kill on the Jellies, making this a 3v1, 2v1, and attackers get their first win of the half.
That's all they needed, just a little aggression, and you can see it. They knew that they had to make a play, and they executed, right? That was a desperation play that worked out, and they need to realize that that is what they needed, right? That was the concise, hey, throw down some utility and rush in at the same time. They can't shoot everyone at once, because usually they can, but at that point, they couldn't. It was just a well-executed play. They knew that the slow play had given it some complacency, and pushing forward in the face of all of that utility coming out of the Viper on the defender's side, very well done by Dartmouth. They now even it out, and finally might be working their way towards a couple more round wins.
I'm excited to see what they do now. Looks like they're going to go for a similar A play. Scuba, though, with the operator, looking to mimic some of these best, but Bruce gets the first kill onto aggressive act, meaning that Dartmouth has a real solid chance of winning this with one player down, and that is their Reyna, so they're going to have a really hard time retaking a site without those flashes.
Yeah, no flashes available, and you can already see the run it back, I think, has timed out. Or is it available? I'm very sorry. So, see if he's able to glean any information. Now, another stack onto A, and they got it. They found the tempo.
Yeah, Dartmouth is able to make their way onto the side. They have pretty solid post plant positions. The Aladrone able to tag some of the players who are doubling up in heaven. Dustel holding on for his life despite getting thrown two mollies. Does get killed by the nano swarm from Altoven. It's now a 4v3. The door is broken, but Kinstar, very nice spray, holds it down. It's now a 4v2. Bruce slowly creeping his way up into heaven for this flank onto the raise with an Odin.
Be able to get it. Yeah, there's the headshot.
Using the operator out of their hands. Oh! Zoom! No, gets the kill on the Bruce and is gonna keep the operator.
Yeah, you know, that's a rough one. That is a rough one. 27 health, no armor.
Oh, you're crying about that one. You got the Odin, one of the big tickets, and then you just... Yeah, there's a Salt Shaker. All right, Scuba.
This quick scope doesn't... Or does work out, rather, in the favor of Scuba, and he gets to keep the Operator, but it is now 11-10 on the side of Dartmouth. Coming back into this half, getting their second round win on T's side, and if they can get one more, that does make it match point, and they'll damage the economy of Springfield.
Yeah, just got to get through one more Odin, another Operator... And three Vandals.
And then you're home free.
Totally. That's so easy to do. Absolutely.
Oh, looks like Dartmouth is going to switch it up, though, and put a lot more pressure onto this B site with five of their players hanging out trying to see what's going on, getting a lay of the land. Scuba, or rather, Bruce throwing out an operate. Who opped there? It was Scuba. Scuba throwing out a warning shot on the op. Doesn't get anyone.
Oh. All I can see is that poor robot bouncing back and forth, but Tiki deciding that this is the corner that you want to hold.
Gets one, doesn't get the second one, does get traded up, and now it's a 4v4. Aggressive Act does have Empress coming out, and they are stalling a little bit, Dartmouth. Let's see if they're going to push onto the side or not. Aladrone coming out. Does spot Aggressive Act, but he does get the kill on the ult open. Bruce gets the train onto Scuba. Now it's 3v3, but this Empress is still active. If the curveball doesn't come out, he's gonna kill Minnesota, making it a 2v2. Bomb is stuck in B main. Looks like they're gonna creep out.
Yeah, this is a 2-on-2, and this is a big round for them. If they're able to pull this off, this is gonna be fantastic. And yes, they flank it! They got the flank!
You love to see that. Omen's going to be planning on this A site, and Jellies and the Rainer are going to be a little bit late, but so is Kinster. Kinster's really far behind, and now they're going to be able to defuse because Kinster's nowhere in sight. If they stick this, I don't think Kinster has enough time.
No, he's trying his best, and I don't think he's going to get it. He's got a couple seconds. No, don't flash. No.
Oh, no. Really well played from Springfield to get that rotate. They caught Bruce on the top of heaven and gets punished for the kind of over-aggressive angle when he didn't have his teammate there on the post plant.
Yeah, but I'm liking this. These last few rounds have made both teams anxious. You can see it. The tempo has picked up. No longer are they waiting till 30 seconds. They're waiting till a minute. Only give that 30 to 40 second prep time and then go for it. I like what I'm seeing from both these squads now. If they can continue executing this, I think the series is going to be even closer than this game here, which I don't think is possible, but we'll see.
Yeah, 11-11. You can't get much closer to this as the pressures are mounting, and we see Dartmouth looking to do another A take, which had been their most successful site so far. Let's see if they can get a pick here.
Oh, robot. Dance it out, and the wall goes up, and a Viper wall as well, so gotta give it a shot.
Yeah, dash on the site from Amian, but the Showstopper does come out. They do kill the Raze, but Tiki does get out Altoven with their ultimate. It's now a 3v2, and the bomb still has not been planted. Cypher, Duskcell just anchoring onto that site, clearing out the attackers, and for some reason, Bruce is still in main, unable to even make his way onto the site yet.
Oh, and look at all of that Viper work right there. Oh, that feels bad. Once all that goes down, he is gone. He's like, oh, there it goes. Scuba picks that one up. And again, I like the attempt. I'm liking these attempts coming out. You can see the thought process going through. And now on point, you got to pull something out, right? You got to pull something out here on Dartmouth. You fought your way back in the first half and second half got away from you a little bit. Now you're on that last point. And like you said, whoever takes the first map, I feel has a huge, huge mental advantage over their opponent. So it's very, very important they bring this one back.
Yeah, especially when this game is so close, 11-12. If they lose now, it'll be devastating. So let's see if Springfield is going to be able to close it out or if Dartmouth is going to bring us into our first overtime.
Yeah. If they do, I mean, might be out the back of Amian.
Yeah, definitely. Amian has been playing out of their mind, and they do have knives. The Brennett back coming out, clearing out the site, gets the door closed and the lockdown, though, getting them so much site control here. Double up, 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 doesn't find anything. And they didn't even one player.
You gotta like that. I got one. Alright.
I got one. Owldrone comes out. Bruce gets the kill onto Jelly, and Aggressive Act does trade it out, making this a 4v4. This retake is super possible on the side of Springfield, but Dartmouth has pretty good post plant positions here, so let's see if they can play together and not get traded out here.
Whoa, there isn't a couple shots. Oh, Altoven.
Tiki kills the Sentinel, making it a 3v3 now as Kinster with the Stinger gets the frag back. They're clearing out under Heaven. Omni gets taken down by Dust Cell. It's now a 3v2 and Viper's on the site. The wall's coming up. They're going to have to Sova ult this, though, in order to get it. He is going to kill Dust Cell. Bomb is halfway, though, and I don't know if Sova has a time. Minnesota did get the kill to scoop up, but the defuse comes out.
Defenders win.
Oh, that was such a close round from Dartmouth there. Almost got the execute with the Sova ult, but couldn't quite land the shock dart to kill the last remaining player.
And that was honestly not how I... slow start because of how these guys seemed a bit anxious on the map, seemed to be a little bit worrisome in terms of how they wanted to aggress and how they want to take these attacking sides. And granted, a little bit easy on the defender side, but I liked what I saw at the end where we started seeing some aggressive plays right around 20 seconds into the round, right? Already pushing in, already trying to use some of that utility to block off vision. So if they can continue that into, I believe it is Bind coming up next, I think we could see a drastically different setup here.
Yeah, I'm excited to see how Dartmouth is going to try to make their way back into this. A really well-played map by Springfield and Amien at the top of the leaderboard, even though their team lost. Amien and Bruce trying to hold it down. They still have a lot of potential to come back on the second map. 11-13 is a super close game, and I'm excited to see how the teams adapt.
Yeah, and so we will be going to a very short break as teams get prepared. Again, that was a very close match, 11-13. Love to see that. Hope we see it again. So just real quick, 5-minute break, and we'll be right back with map number two between Dartmouth and Springfield College. and welcome back to our opening match here at the NECC Valorant Week 2. We are still in the Emergence Series here between Dartmouth and Springfield, which map number one came down to an extremely close match, 13-11 on Ascent, with, I believe it was Springfield, taking that win.
Yeah, Springfield looked really good on defense. Both teams had pretty shaky offending sides, but Springfield was able to get just more rounds out, and they looked pretty strong going in.
Yeah, and so that's something that we both noticed is, you know, the attackers having a little bit of difficulty deciding where they want to go, deciding how they want to set up. And towards the end, though, we saw a shift, right? Bruce popping off quite often with that op, even on the attacking side. Amian still getting 2K every so often. I mean, these are the two players I think we're taking a look at to really step up and carry the side of Dartmouth over to a map win.
Yeah, really well played by both teams. I'm excited to see how the comps and how their playstyles change a little bit on Bind. Bind, as we know, is a really rotate heavy map, so it has to do with a lot of, you know, faking that you're going one way and then ending up on a completely different bomb site due to the teleporter mechanic of the map. So a much different playstyle than Ascent, where mid control is super dominant, super important. I'm excited to see what these teams have for us.
Yeah, hopefully not getting stuck in any pinch situations. I think close to 20 or 22, we saw a good little flank coming out on both defender sides. So I really like to see some of those, but at the same time, you want to see a little bit of aggression and being able to make that decision at a snap if you realize you have maybe two members pushing on your backside. But we are coming in here. So again, some of the agents that we saw, Reyna came out, had mild to decent success over on both attacking and defending on the Springfield side, I believe. Do you think we're going to see anything different here?
I'm hoping to see a kind of shift away from Reyna. I wasn't too impressed by what we saw last time, even though I think the Reyna was the highest fragger on the side of Springfield. But I'm excited to see if we can see any more Phoenix picks, more Silva picks, maybe even a Yoru or something. I think there's so much like capability for champions like Phoenix, who can flash onto site, who can run onto site, or champions like Omen, who have the teleport mechanic. That's why I think Yoru could end up being really good on a map like Bind, where it is all about the rotations, about outplaying your opponents, about where they could be. And Yoru just got a buff, so maybe I can manifest a Yoru pick coming in, but not quite sure if we'll see it.
Yeah, unfortunately, we actually got the lock-in for both Reyna and Omen. So Omen, though, we saw to great effect being used. Bruce actually popped off, I think, in that second-to-last round. It was a very nice teleport play over from B main into the A site. Just unfortunately, the Phoenix on his team was a little bit slow on the rotate as well. But we do have a Brimstone Duxcell bringing it out on the defender side first. A little bit of a change here, it looks like.
Yeah, after Brimstone got buffed in the two patches ago, so not this patch, but the last one, his smoke time increased to 20 seconds. He does have three of them, which gives him an advantage over Omen, especially if you're going to go for really fast takes onto either side. Once you're ready to execute, you have 20-second smokes, and you have three of them. And they also buffed his stim pack, so we have been seeing a lot more Brimstone in competitive play, so I'm excited to see what these teams can do with him now.
Yeah, and we can't ever forget Sova, though, because I wanted to point out Sova's, both of them, in the last game had some fantastic ultimates coming up, cutting through some of the walls and finding those important picks. Multiples of them actually were, I believe, actually catching the spike diffuser at that time. So using those ultimates to great effect, using those shock darts also to manifest a little bit of room for yourself. I think both of those, both players will be looking to have some of that same impact as before.
Yeah, especially when you have both teams opted for the Sentinel pick of Killjoy, and Killjoy's ultimate can be destroyed with both Sova ulti as well as Brimstone ulti, so the post plants from both teams are going to be really exciting as we get way into our first round. We do have kind of a lean towards B on the side of the attackers.
Yeah, short and long holding 2 and 3. Couple arrows of Tiki. Oh!
Tiki.
Okay, he made up for it.
This is a shock dart, but does get the one tap onto Ami and making it a 4v3 now on this site as Kinstar makes his way, but does get traded out by Aggressive Act with a 2k on terrain. It's now a 4v1, and I'm not sure exactly what Omen can do here. comes late to the TP. The bot spike is down on the site, so this Oma's gonna have a really hard time retaking this, especially through the brimstone smoke.
Oh, Bruce is just sitting there like, I want to try something. I don't know what it is, Dandy. I get one.
Just gonna get
Scuba said I'm done.
Classicked by Scuba and a really solid round from Springfield. As we said before, Springfield's defense has been super solid. They won the game off of their really strong defense. So it'll be interesting to see how Dartmouth can adapt. Dartmouth hadn't had a really impressive T side, and this pistol round didn't go their way either, but this map is defense-sided, so it'll be interesting to see if they can get anything done on this anti-eco round they're gonna go into.
Yeah, I think stats pulled were close to like 51 or 52% for defenders overall, which in my opinion is still pretty good, right? Like, that's pretty heavily sided and indexed towards that defender side, so hopefully they can continue, some improvements over that would be decision making, like having that decision made, finding the information, and flip that actually. So finding the information and making the decision. But Jelly really says, yeah, decision is just a kill.
Oof, the curveball onto site, but aggressive act does take him out with the Spectre. But Jelly's gets a 3K with the Sheriff onto these armorless attackers. And now it's going to be Bruce, the last left alive again. Bruce is often the last alive on their team. I feel like he's not really making his way onto the site when his team is pushing. And he's gonna get spotted by the Owl Drone. But if not, Duskcell will take him out with a stinger. And that's the second round going on the side of Springfield.
Yeah, as the lurker on your team, though, which he has been multiple times now, we see him always hanging back, you know, waiting to see where the opponents go. I feel this is always how it goes out, because you are not one of the primary attackers usually moving into a site. So I don't feel rough for his team that he is the last one dead, or last one alive. I should say that sounded bad, but it's always unfortunate that it is that occurrence, right? You don't want to see your team falling so quickly because you're also trying to filter information to them. So far, the aggression I like coming out from the side of Springfield. However, a little bit better execution and possible rotations with information might be better.
Yeah, luckily Dartmouth does have a full gun round, and they're going to be going into the bonus round, so they do have the gun advantage. The curveball goes out, flashes the player in heaven. Doesn't get a lot for it, though, but as I say, the Amian does get the kill on the Jelly, so now it's a 5v4, so it looks like they're going to be able to take this A site pretty easily. Kenstar gets the kill onto aggressive act. Now a 5v3, leaving Springfield to play retake, but Bruce does take out Duskcell, and now it's a 4v2, and the plant does go down.
Yeah, and I'm liking this right now. This is what you want to do. You get a couple kills and you push, and you know that they have to cover a few other areas, so you know that players will rotate. That is the whole game plan. They get on there, they set up properly with four, and now Tiki is just left 31 health in a dream. Can someone help me out here?
Yeah, he has a Guardian hand. Luckily, on the side of Springfield, their econ is looking pretty good, so this round isn't totally devastating, and they did come into it with bonus weapons, but if they could get one more gun off of the hands of Dartmouth, it would be better, but it doesn't look like anyone's going to push towards CT or Heaven at all, so Tiki's just going to walk away with his Guardian.
Yeah, and I like, I always like teams not greeting for kills. You see it a lot in a lot of these games, you know, running away, always thinking that, hey, we can find a couple kills, but that's actually how you lose a lot of your eco. That's how you lose a lot of credits for no reason, right? You already won the round. You already got the kills that you needed, and you got the plant. What more could you want? Why give your opponent that much extra? In certain situations, you usually see the defender that has to run, try and circle around, get a flank, but at this point, I think it's right. Just hold off. Give it some time.
Yeah, especially when you're in the position that Dartmouth was in, and you know that even if you got the Guardian off Sova, they could still just buy a gun for their teammate anyway. It wouldn't make that big of a difference, and they didn't really have the money to buy this round if they lost a weapon, so a really good call from Dartmouth there. Sova Recon coming out, so you can get any info on what Dartmouth is thinking, but he does get the ult orb for free, which is always very nice, especially on a high-impact ult like Sova's.
Gotta love, and double drones actually comes out, so a little bit of peeking on both.
Gets the tag onto Phoenix, and Phoenix is going to fall back out of Hookah. It looks like they're going to do a full five-man rotate onto A, but they are actually going to leave Jet lurking around Hookah to see if anyone pushes out after them.
Yeah. I do like this hold, and again, two holds on the back ends. They're going to find Brimstone once, but Bruce says not anymore.
Yeah, Bruce gets the headshot onto Duskcell, making this a 5v4. Phoenix already has control of U-Haul, so that means that Springfield here is going to play a complete retake. Heaven is smoked out by Omen's Dark Cover, means the retake's gonna be delayed just a little bit. The Sova Recon does reveal some. Kenstar gets the kill on the Tiki, and Aggressback does trade it out, making this a 4v3 retake for the defenders.
Man, and this is... It feels like a whole new team. Altoven grabbing a kill. Bruce as well popping off. And this is Dartmouth coming out of nowhere.
Yeah, really good gun round coming out of Dartmouth. There's only one left alive. Not sure exactly what they can do. And Bruce gets the 3K to take out Aggressive Act. And that's the second round going over to Dartmouth on the attacking side.
Minnesota actually... Okay, I was worried the bomb went off, and then I realized it doesn't go off that quickly. But again, I love seeing that. Beautiful job from Dartmouth. They find the kills, and again, the picks. Bruce getting on that aim, now 5-2-1. Yes, use that information. You know you found a couple picks. Good. Push as soon as you know, or, you know, if you do have to play a little bit slower. But at this point, the line is spread very, very thin between these, between the defenders, right? You do have to split. It's a little bit long going all the way through B Hall, all the way to Towers, and vice versa. So if you get one or two picks, know that you have a couple seconds extra where your opponents will not be there, and that is the time you utilize your man advantage in those situations.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. Minnesota is out joining through Hookah, realizes that nobody is holding it, so that means that both of the players on this B-bomb site are going to be on the site and not in Hookah, even though they have short-range weapons, which is kind of an interesting choice. But it does look like it's not going to be too big of a deal as Dartmouth looks their way on getting some information on this A-site.
Yep. Slow little attempts and a little bit quiet, so I like them slowing the pace down after those first... 30 seconds or so.
The Dark Cover coming with the Silver Recon Dart does not land. The run effect gets taken out instantly, and Belly gets a kill on Minnesota through the smoke. Bomb is now down. Aggressive Act gets the one tap onto Altoven with the Sheriff, meaning it's a 3v3, and they don't have this site yet. Bruce does have control of bathrooms, but he's really low health bar right now.
Very, very low. I think it's about 10, and yep, that goes the rest of it.
Yeah, the Sova ult, ults the Spike Planter on default and does slow down the plant, but it looks like Dartmouth is just going to rotate onto this B site, and they are going to get the plant down, though the defenders are really close, but they're not going to challenge the plant. So Amien's going to be able to get some U-Haul control.
Uh-oh, face check. Oh, Amien grabs one, might get two. No, can't grab the 2K.
Yeah, one member left alive from Dartmouth stuck in Hookah. It is a 2v1, and Jelly's with a 3K headshot. Cinches that round for Springfield, so really well played by Springfield there.
Yeah, and it definitely feels both these teams actually have played this map a lot, right? Map number one, on Ascent, it felt that they were shaky moving into some of those attacking positions. This one, they seem a lot more sure of themselves on both defense and offense, right? Dartmouth taking some of those aggressive plays, finding those picks, and then moving forward almost immediately afterwards, not waiting to see if someone rotate over, right? So I'm liking this tempo change. Now let's see if they can continue this, because again, like you said, defender-sided map, and if it's 3-2 already, if it's a defender-sided map, I am favoring Dartmouth in terms of moving over to the second half.
Yeah, especially on attacking side, if you can get even 5 rounds coming in, that'll be huge for Dartmouth, because that'll just put so much less pressure on them when they're on this defensive half, considering their defensive half has looked really solid. Aldron gets shot out. Doesn't get too much information, realizes that Reyna's playing in Hookah.
Ultimate's up for Amien too. Might want to try and make a play if he can.
Finds the Killjoy turret, takes it out after a couple of missed shots. But Minnesota gets the one tap onto Jellies, but Aggressive Act responds with a 2K, but is now with 3v3, and there's only one defender left on the site. Killjoy lockdown is gonna go down, pushing out that Killjoy right into the nuts. Amien, as he gets the right click. Tiki does trade it out, means it's a 2v2. Recon dart comes out, but Bruce punishes him with a shock dart in hand, and now it's a 1v2 retake for Dusk Cell.
Man, this is a whole new team. They are playing coordinated, they're playing aggressive, they're playing up to tempo, and I like this. This is this group that they needed, and again, maybe it's Bruce hitting the shots where he needs, using that crouch toggle effectively, and hitting those body-to-head shots. I mean, this man has been on fire, sitting at 7-3-1. He's been the one to find most of the picks as well that have enabled his team to close in on this round. So, Dust Cell, last one, and trying to clear it out, but...
Yeah, a lot of these players have died with utility in their hand, which means when they're casting their utility, they're not clearing their angles or they're not in a safe place to be doing so, and I'm glad that the other team has been punishing them most of the time.
Yeah, gotta use about all that you can. Don't want to be hanging onto that at the end of the round. That's the same as, you know, giving up half of a round, I feel, or giving up any advantages that you can, right? Might as well use it if you got it. And that's always the nice part of Valorant, kind of restocks on its own, if you will.
Yeah, and Springfield looks like they're going to be on a light buy. Only Sheriff's coming out as they're in this safe situation. Their econ isn't looking really good. They will have enough to buy next round, but if they can get a Thrifty off here, at least get some guns off the side of Dartmouth, would really help them kind of like shoulder up on this defensive side.
Yeah, and as soon as they're spotted, I think that we're going to see a hard push. I wouldn't be surprised as soon as you notice that the other team is running just like Sheriffs and a couple classics. Might as well, right? Unless you don't have armor against the Sheriff.
Yeah, the Recon Dart comes out, finds out the entire site is clear. The only thing they haven't cleared is two, but Sova's still in this garden, has the potential to get a cheese pick here, playing an off angle against this Jet. Oh, he only has a classic though. Let's see if he can do anything with it. The defensive side, Killjoy lockdown goes out, and Ami doesn't even check his corner. Gets punished for it. It's now a 4v3 coming out of this side of Dartmouth. A really bad play from Ami there not to check his corner. Garden wasn't cleared.
That is so much pain right there, but Aggressive might find a little bit of action.
Ooh. Kinstar does get the kill in Dusk Cell. No armor, no gun on the side of Dusk Cell, so kind of an easy kill, but now it's a 4v2. The retake's going to be really difficult for Aggressive Act here. He does have two leers, but uses the first one.
Yep, and trying the others and throws it down. Oh, jellies! Mirrored action from the Phoenix squad. Last
player standing. Yeah, gets the kill through the Molly, but it looks like Aggressive Act's going to take a gun and run away.
Yeah, and some of these deaths, I'm starting to wonder. It's just like, you know, little micro mechanics. I stated before in map number one, but this map as well, some of these things should be kind of the basics of basics, right? Check your corners, pre-fire. It sounds like a noobish thing to do, but I think it's very, very good, right? Taking a couple shots, giving away your position when you're trying to get that information, when you're trying to find that one or two pick, it's never a bad thing. Drop a couple shots, scare your opponent as well, and you might be surprised at what you find. So always check your corners, people. That's rule number one in FPS.
Oh, definitely. But not Springfield doesn't have to feel too bad about the last round. They were able to get two guns, I think, out of the hands of Dartmouth, mm-hmm. So that helped a little bit. And now they have a full gun round. So this is really Springfield's round to kind of play together as defenders and see if they can stop this really impressive Dartmouth T-side.
And jellies with the spray and pray. One to the body, two to the head, and three possibly to go.
Disappointing that Springfield wasn't, or Dartmouth wasn't able to trade out that kill, but Minnesota finally gets the headshot on the jellies, ending an impressive reign, but it's now a 4v3 for Dartmouth on this attacking side.
Now they're just gonna hold inside, and I think this is the right call here. Again, you don't know where the spike is. You haven't seen the spike holder just yet, so might as well hold all. Now the call immediately runs straight over.
Yeah, it's a 2v4 now, and Bruce does get the kill and Aggressive Act, making it a 2v3. This is winnable for Dartmouth, but it gets sprayed through the dark cover he placed there himself. The recon bolt reveals Ami and gets one kill on Death Cells. Now a 2v1 gets the second headshot. A 1v1 with the Sova shock dart takes out Ami and ends any hope of a clutch.
I mean, you gotta be proud of yourself after that one. Amien did work, dropping some members, and that's gonna set the defenders down just a little bit. Amien's actually been kind of struggling thus far, having a hard time finding some of those kills, but so far starting to find his rhythm as well. So another full buy coming out of the attackers here. And again, like you said, all they need is that 5-round hold. If they get that, they should be okay moving into the defenders' side of the map. And if they're able to pull this off, I think that is going to be huge numbers for them.
Yeah, important to note, Duskcell does have his Brimstone Ultimate, so he does have that available. But on the other side of Dartmouth, they do have Sova ult. So post-plant, they're going to really want to be looking for playing for the Sova ult. But the running back does come out of Hookah. The Paranoia comes out on long. Tiki does get taken out by Kenstar, so now it's a 5v4. As Minnesota gets the second kill, and now it's a 4v3, and Dartmouth basically has the site. They don't have elbow control yet, and it looks like Kenstar's gonna go try to get some.
Yeah, and again, the tempo shift has been immeasurable here. Fast, quick, easy to play off. And again, yes, you lose a couple members, but here you go. Oh, caught in the act.
3v1 for Bruce here, stuck in this garden position. The Molly goes down. ults to safety, CT. It looks like they are going to just stick this defuse there. Bruce doesn't really have a lot he can do.
He did grab a gun. I think he picked one up and ran. I'm not sure what gun he picked up, so we'll see. Next round start. Oh, he got one on the back end. Again, why are you chasing? Why do you need to chase at the... Come on. That's going to be a pet peeve of mine. I'm so sorry.
Does get punished for it, too. If you're going to chase for these guns, you have to make sure it's worth for you in terms of just pure economics. Luckily, and if you look on the side of Dartmouth, they can't do a full buy, and neither actually can Springfield.
Okay, SMG for Minnesota, so he's the one running without a full, sitting with 500 extra credits in his pocket. But again, armor, I think, is a big thing. So they have four Vandals and armor, so I think they're pretty much set for this attacking side as well.
He's gonna get picked out. The dash away lives with his life. There is two in bathrooms, but Amin, I think, should be safe to just jump away. Yeah, he's fine. I really like this coming out of the defender players, though. Having two players play the same angle on the site where you have more than two defenders means you can play together because you have the numbers advantage.
Yeah, and I think this swap back and forth has been pretty good as well. So far, again, these guys, map number one may have been the short end, right? The one map that you kind of give on both ends. Take your time, try and figure out what you want to do, and that's going to be the firefight breaking out.
Oh, yeah, Kins are the curveball out. Get Scuba, the over-rotate coming on the side, and Tiki is going to get one, though. Gets Kenstar for this trouble. It's now a 4v4 retake. Retaking on B is really difficult as Deli gets taken out by Bruce. The Brim Sky Smoke doesn't quite get Hookah.
Yeah, this is definitely a Dartmouth map to run. They have done so well so far on this attacking side. Yes, they have not clinched as many runs as they probably would have liked, but still, getting the plants down, excessively so, they have so far shown that they know this map, they know what they need to do, and hopefully can keep capitalizing on such.
Yeah, Aggressive Act runs onto this site. Minnesota does take out Tiki. It's now a 3v1. The Brimstone ult has already gone out. The Orbital Strike didn't get a kill. Does get out Minnesota. Don't think he gets any more, though, and he's going to die to this bomb.
No! You hate to see it.
Yeah, really well played, though, from Dartmouth, getting five rounds on their attacking side, which had been their weaker side. I'm excited to see if they can get the advantage here. The guns are in their favor. Springfield is looking kind of broke. Looks like they're going to go for either a full save or like a light buy onto Jellies, and that's about it.
Yeah, that's that also pains you in the round right before, or two rounds before half, right? Having to eco just feels like you're giving up the next two rounds, right? Like that's or the next round afterwards. And you hate to see it, so hopefully they can find a couple picks. Hopefully they can move it into a 6-6 by round half. They can't. I mean, that's going to be rough for attacking.
Yeah, the Aladrone comes out, but Kenstar gets Dust Cell off the info. The Silva ultimate is going out. Not sure if he tagged. I think he tagged one, but doesn't quite get the kill. It's now a 5v4. Reyna's super low health bar as Amian gets a kill and the Jellies out of bathrooms. Amian's already on the site. Gets a 2k, jumps into heaven. Protected by the start cover from Omen. Has a really good position to catch the Sova who's creeping up and does get the kill. It's a 3k for Amian as Bruce gets the kill in a Scuba, and that's another round going to Dartmouth.
Yep, and here it all is again. They got six. They got one more than you predicted. One more than you said they need to feel comfortable. I mean, if they push it to a 7-5, that's going to be even more celebration. And Bruce so far, 13-5 has been crushing it. And I mean, I can't wait until he gets... I don't think he's going to bring the op out here. Not too many angles to really use it on. But still, doing so well with these flanks. And Amian, you can definitely see he is also starting to come online, starting to find those angles and holds.
Yeah, on your attacking side as a Jet player, you really want to see Jets that they're not opping to be taking these really aggressive pushes onto the site. And that's what Amian's been doing. He's been dashing onto site and at least getting a frag or two before he gets traded out. In the last round, he got three. Amian's really been stepping it up in this later half of this attacking side.
A couple shock darts missing in action.
They do now tag the Killjoy, though, and does get the kill. Amian gets the knives reset as he pushes onto the site. Tiki does take out Minnesota and Amian with his knives out. It's now a 4v2. The Killjoy locked down, does go out, and Bruce kills Tiki, though. It's now a 2v3.
Oh, the party was not in his favor, but he still got three, and Dust Cell might just clean it up.
Odin coming out, Killjoy running around for her life, gets the first kill on Jellies, can't quite compete with the Odin though, and now it's a 6-6 half on Vine so far.
Man, that is a... Man, I wanted another close match just like before, and I think we're gonna get it. So now the question, right, coming out now, is can Springfield execute just as well on the attacking side as Dartmouth, right? Dartmouth, fantastic run, never let more than two rounds slip out of their pocket. And this time around, they are the ones in control. They were on the defender side, of course, last time. So what can they do? How can they offset Dartmouth, who definitely seem that this map is their home?
Yeah, I'm going to have to see some interesting plays coming out of Springfield if they want to be able to maintain, or they want to go ahead. They need to win at least seven more rounds to win. They do have two flash agents, so I really want to see Phoenix and Reyna utilizing their flashes to get onto these sites, because last match we didn't see it all too much, and I would love to see them improve upon that.
Yep, that's what you would hope, but again, I guess it's more of a mental thing, but, you know, it's like the RPG factor. You start stacking all those items, those healing potions, whatever you have, and you're like, well, I'll use it later, I'm sure, you know? But no, in this, you get it back every single round. Just go ahead, toss it. Please use those abilities when you have it. Understand that these will come back very quickly for you. These are not something that you need to hang on to for two rounds later.
Yeah, Aggressive Act gets the first entry kill onto Bruce, gets the second one onto Kensar. It's now a 5v3 as Omian is taken down to 4 HP. Does get the kill on Aggressive Act, though. Jellies does take him out. It's now a 4v2. Luckily, the defenders are already on the site, peeking into CT. Sova Recon Dart going out, trying to get some info, but Dusk Cell pushes Minnesota with his arrows out, and now it's Killjoy stuck in heaven, stuck in the sky smoke. It's gonna get flanked. But this Brimstone here rotates around, gets the headshot on a Dusk Cell. That's disappointing, but this round's pretty much won for Springfield, unless Altova can get a miracle here.
You hear the footsteps in the... Oh! Point blank. Running will do that.
Yeah, really well played. Coming into Springfield, we talked about how they were going to have to work on their attacking side to make some action, and they really do, getting the first round on this attacking side.
Is it weird to say that on a defender-favored map, both these teams feel more comfortable attacking? Like, is that a weird point to say? Like, it just feels like that. These guys know exactly where they want to go, moving through either B-long, moving through the port sides and showers. I mean, no matter where they go, they feel much more comfortable. They're checking some of their angles a lot more, and the pre-fire has been somewhat there as well.
Yeah, and I think something about Bind is that, like, the B side in specific is so hard to retake when you are the defending side, and if you're not playing for the flank for this rotate, and neither of the teams have really been doing it. Does the Molly line up hit there?
Jelly's watching some YouTube videos, marking up his spot. I love seeing those cheeky plays. It always can give you an advantage if you get that sweet lucky roll.
Yeah, it looks like Dartmouth already has sending Bruce over, so it's going to be a 4v5 take if Springfield decides to commit to this. The Killjoy Mollies are selling out the push really severely, though. Killjoy gets taken down to 20% HP with the first Sova Shock Dart. The second one takes him down even lower. Tiki gets one kill. Aggressive Act gets the other. It's now a 5v3. Retake for the defender is going to be pretty difficult. They do have the gun advantage, though, but it doesn't seem to matter.
Yeah, this is... honestly, if I was watching this and this was the first map, I would not think that these were the same two teams that we saw before, right? Like, these are drastically different, and they feel so much more at home, and I'm loving it. Jellies dropping one with that Sheriff, and again, pistol flawless coming out here for Springfield, and this is, I mean, I think you lied to me. This is not a defender-sided map. These guys are playing it like it's all attackers all day, every day.
Yeah, Springfield really impressed, especially on pistol rounds and eco rounds. It's so good to be playing with your teammates so you can get those trade kills out on this attacking side, and they're doing that really well. I wonder if that's why we see them succeeding a little more on Bind, where the map is a little more closed off, as opposed to a map like Ascent, where you play a lot of split mid to Bs, mid to As, but I wonder if they're going to end up getting punished for this with flanks coming out of Dartmouth, or if Dartmouth is going to keep letting them get away with this.
So the question I think there actually comes is, did Dartmouth even read these, right? The question is have they picked up on these minute differences in the play style and the minute changes in the rotations? Because if you are not reading your opponent at that point, which you have a minute or so to do, you need to utilize that information in this goes, this is a constant kind of circle, if you will. You know, it's constantly, all right, opponent made one change, we change, and then the opponent reads our change, so they change, and constantly back and forth. It's who can adapt to it the quickest? Who can pick up on this read the fastest? And what do you use for that information? So you can see right there, I think Jellies is actually checking that top part. Yeah, he's trying to shoot through the wall on it, and I actually really like that.
Yeah, especially when an Omen player is on that site, it's a very common spot for Omens to try to play off angles. The Reyna Leer is coming out, though, as he pushes into short. Doesn't get to clear U-Haul due to the smoke, but Jellies gets the frag onto Minnesota, making it a 5v4. One member left alive on this site. Aggressive Act just pushing into U-Haul. They haven't cleared out short yet. I wonder if they're going to be cognizant enough to get this kill, and it looks like they are. Kenstar doesn't even check his U-Haul. The Recon Dart does take out Killjoy. They know that one CT. Tiki reloads and punishes the score by Altovin. Aggressive Act takes him out for his trouble. And now it's Amian left to the 4v1 retake. Not a whole lot he can do. I think the most he's going to try to get here is get some guns out of their hands, but...
I have not seen anything like that in a very long time. Actually counting how many bullets came out of the gun, knowing to pop in at that exact time. If that's what actually happened, I have to congratulate him. That's what afforded that single kill. Very well done.
Yeah, a fourth round? No, third round on this attacking side, coming onto the side of Springfield. Really well played. I've been super impressed with Springfield. I was a little hesitant to be confident in their attacking side, especially how their Reyna and Phoenix played last game, but they've really stepped it up, getting a lot of entry frags and drawing a lot of pressure onto the site.
Yeah, I think honestly, Jellies has been the most shocking factor for me, right? The pre-fire early, drawing two members. Jellies, I think, has been kind of... Some of the ultimate shots with those arrows through the walls has been great, but Aggressive and Jellies together have made this unbeatable battery running through most of these rounds here, and has enabled their squad to be able to move up to a 9-6 on an attacking side. Like, that should not... That's not normal by any stretch of the imagination here in Valorant.
Yeah, the fake Omen TP, I don't think it tripped up Springfield all too much as they continue to creep on, but there's only two members left on this site. The thing about Dartmouth is they've been giving up so much of their site, and they're gonna get punished for it as the running back comes out. Jellies checks his corner, does get taken out, but he's still gonna come back. That's his ultimate. Amian gets the first frag with a frenzy onto Aggressive Ag. It's now a 4v4. Not unwinnable for the defenders, but Scuba makes it a little more difficult.
The blind!
Beautifully played by Jellies there. Gets the bomb down too. The Recon Dart does spot out the Phoenix multiple times. Gets sprayed through the walls, taking down to like 10 HP maybe.
Ooh, yeah. Dropped to about 10 HP and then dropped by Dust Cell. And I mean, all of a sudden, Springfield looked like they are online. And I think these tag team duo plays are really showing here, right? You see it in a lot in like FPSs such as, you know, Rainbow Six or CSGO, where some tag team plays can come out where you have an opponent try and bait and then you do a wraparound. But in Valorant, it's so much more obvious whenever it occurs because you actually have ability synergies, right? Using your abilities at certain times and allowing your team to get an advantage, such as the Phoenix Wall and Flash, into, say, a Reyna flank or anything of the sort. I really like seeing these tag team plays, and I want to see teams execute even more on them. You know, these micro pushes or mini flanks have been doing so well for them.
Tragic. You see two kills coming out on the map. Jet pushed out at Hookah as a defender and got taken out by the lurking attacking member of the team. And then Phoenix just taken out by Jellies. And if you're Dartmouth here, you have to wonder what you're doing wrong on your defense side, right? They're not setting up crossfires. They're not playing together. And they're getting punished for it. They're just losing these gun battles. They can't keep taking these 1v1s like this if they want to hold on to this match.
And it's so hard, right? Like, we can keep going on them about some of these gun battle losses or some of these round losses just to straight up 1v1 fights. But at the same time, this is actually what's been instilled in them, right? In the past four rounds, this is exactly what Springfield have done to their mentality. It's gone from, we're going to slow play, we're going to try and slowly creep in, get some information, get a couple shots, to we take one kill, we push. So now, at this point, Dartmouth are actually, in my opinion, Springfield, actually terrified, right? You're worried about where your opponents are constantly going to go, and that's all in the mind game. At some point, their mental, it feels like, has been broken, right? What can we do? How do we do this? We don't know, right? We don't even know what the opponent's going to do. If you can't get a read and your mental is shattered, you will lose 70 to 80 to 90% of any gun battles because you do not know where your opponent will come from. Your aim drops, and there's so much that goes wrong. So pulling back mentally is quite possibly the hardest part of all this.
Yeah, you need to see, you expect to see Dartmouth doing something different here. They had to change something up. They're just kind of getting rolled on this defense side, and now they're on an eco round as well. They do have the operator to play around, so unless Bruce can get a pick here, it might be another round loss for Dartmouth.
Yeah, and I'm very sorry. Yes, you are correct. Dartmouth, whatever I said before, please flip it to the other side. That is my bad. But it still holds true. And we see it now, finally, maybe trying to use that Sova ultimate, hopefully trying to find a little bit of damage, and it's just missing its mark right now.
Yeah, Bruce peeking out through the smoke. He knows he has to get a pick here. One of the only members on his team with a gun, but the running back coming out again on his T-side. Aggressive Act gets the kill on the Omni, and make that Ooh. Two kills the operator. Really well played by Aggressive Act. Gets the third frag. And Reyna buffs. Aggressive Act does not know them. Playing like nothing has changed. Another 4-2 retake for poor Springfield, or Dartmouth here, rather.
And the fast takes. This is what I was hoping for. This is what I was wanting to see, Alice, this entire time. I wanted to see them, and this is confidence, right? This is confidence oozing out of every single pore of them. They know that when they take a kill, they can follow up. And again, off of Aggressive Act and Jellies, right? Jellies goes in with the running back, drops in, gets dropped. No one expects Aggressive to already be right behind him. And that's a 4K. 4K. Get the 5.
Oh,
get
he
the,
wants get the it. He Come wants on. It. I think Kenstar does not want any part of that. Gonna run away. Deny Aggressive Act the ace. But Aggressive Act is gonna push him. I don't know if he has enough time, though.
He's going for it. This one I actually agree with. Chase to your heart's content. Chase, is he gonna get it? Oh, yeah, he got
the ace for Aggressive Act. Match point. 12-6 match point. Aggressive Act with the ace on Reyna, proving maybe why she needs the buffs. And really, really rough defense side coming out of Dartmouth here. They're not setting up the crossfires. I also think one of the biggest problems with their defense right now is that there's so little pressure that Springfield's had about a flank. I think they've only tried to flank one time. Dartmouth has only tried to flank one time on defense, and the jet just got instantly picked. Like, they've never tried to push off from the enemy bomb site. That just gives Springfield has complete control of mid and the bomb site they're taking.
And it's so well done. You actually see Bruce now. I think that's his first Marshall buy. Here, definitely seems like he is much more comfortable on these one shots using these scopes to great advantage, but it's just not the map to do it, as we do see a 1-for-1.
Oh, gets the tag onto Aggressive Act. I think it might have been a collab why it only did 150 or some 140, but Bruce gets another shot that misses. He's into heaven, but somehow gets the pick on a Dust Cell who had the time to see it. Now a 3v2. This is still winnable for Dartmouth here.
Yeah, considering Tiki has the op.
Yeah.
Tiki picked up an op.
Tiki gets taken out by Altoven. It's now a 1v3. Any hopes of winning? Oh, it's a 3v1, actually. I'm totally concerned. Scoobo has this round. Right? You should run. Enemy lockdown does come out. Yeah, Altoven just takes it out. Never mind. Well, they figured it out.
Yeah, they figured it out a little bit, but I think this is also the mental game that comes in, right? I've been talking about it so much because I think it is a huge part of games and any sports, right? The mental game that you play in, and it's really, you can't see it in a scoreline. You can't see it at all. It's a very hard read to get it. But at that point, I really think Dartmouth kind of threw caution to the wind, right? At that point, you know, Bruce picked up that Marshall and now actually grabbed the operator as well. But it's a lot more aggressive style from them. Like you said, trying to push and trying to get those links and trying to get those reads. This is what you have to do. The tempo shift that already happened for Springfield, now happening for Dartmouth. I mean, this is literally your last stand consistently for the next, I don't know, I think 6 rounds you have to do this for. So keep playing aggressive, keep playing like you are going to win, and hopefully you can bring it back.
The Killjoy did put their turret backwards. I don't think that was intentional, but I am not a Sentinel player. What do I know? Gonna be a push into Hookah. The bomb, some Killjoy mollies go out, and the Defender Killjoy ult does come out, slowing down this push. There is now a flank coming out of Dartmouth, though. Dartmouth is gonna be able to catch some of this rotation. It's gonna be the Phoenix versus the Reyna, though, so a 1v1 gun battle, but Jellies gets stuck in the Defender ult. You think the Phoenix is gonna push this here. Gonna find himself in Aggressive Axe crosshair, however, does get punished for the flank. Recon Dart taken out very quickly, doesn't get too much information. It's now a 5v4. This is match point for Springfield here. Let's see if they can capitalize on it.
The potential, a little bit of a scope in Minnesota, trying to drop some pain and just not finding it.
Yeah, but Springfield's already rotating onto this A site. Bomb is in A, but Omian is holding bathrooms. He's ready for this. He has the judge in hand. Let's see if he can get a kill here. Gets the first one. Grabs the Vandal. It's now a 3v3, and Bomb is at A still, but the rotate is going to come out from Dartmouth here.
Now, that double take was the problem, but Omian finally finds one on Jellies, head-to-head between the two second top fraggers on their team right now. That might be a B take. You got about 10 seconds.
10 seconds. I don't know if she has enough time to make this 7. It's going to be really close. No, she doesn't have enough time, so she's just going to walk away. Save the round. You know, Dartmouth hanging in there, getting their 8th win, their 2nd round win on Defender's side. They're kind of coming back into this game. I'm really impressed with them.
Yeah, that is... Yeah, it shows a little bit, right? And I'm very happy for them. And hopefully, if they can take this 3rd round, I will be very happy. Because at that point, you've already negated a lot of the credit that has been built up on the enemy's side. Actually, I take that back because they're all sitting still around 3 or 5. So 2 more rounds, if you do this for this round and the next, you will have that potential to really weed them out and come back. Because again, technically this is supposed to be a defender-sided map. This is the time to start showing it. You're starting to get a good read, start pushing in, and the flanks, the double flank coming out was fantastic for them. I feel that's what really gave them that edge and forced the side of Springfield to kind of second guess what they're about to do.
Yeah, that orbital strike is in the hands of Springfield here. The offshot gets the Owl Dome, but now they know where the operator is playing. That's huge information on the side of Springfield here, knowing where the Dartmouth operator is. The orbital strike's not going to find anyone, as everyone had already evacuated Garden. And Jelly's not quite able to get the frag onto the Sova.
A little bit of a peek through that little edge and can't find any shots, unfortunately. So kind of a wasted opportunity.
They now 4 defenders on this side of Dartmouth. Barely misses the off shot there. Recon Dart goes out, but Bruce gets his first off shot, lands on Dusk Cell, making this a 5v4. Jelly's flashes out, gets the kill onto the operator. It's now a 3v3. Tiki with his kill of his own. 3v2. Bomb has not been planted yet, but Sova's got it, planting it now. Kinstar does have elbow. Just misses Killjoy running into Garden, though.
Oh, but found another one. Tiki getting dropped now. Spike is down. So let's see if the wall is going to be any help to him.
Kinstar gets the kill into aggressive action. Now a 2v1 for match point. Let's see if the Killjoy can do anything. Scuba gets taken out. And oh, Omian gets the kill. And now it's a 12-9. I think they're going to go grab the operator.
Now they need one more round, though. This is Springfield trying their best to close out. But Dartmouth, finally, if they win this round, I feel they have clinched at least one more. This should be the rest of the eco. No, is it still not? Oh my lord. They had way more than I thought built up.
They had won 6 rounds in a row on this attacking side.
Oh my gosh. They had way more than I expected. You're still seeing 2, 3, 4K. And now at this point, I think they're going to have the losing bonus. Bonus coming out. So that is painful. That is painful. That's all I can say right there.
Yeah, really rough. Altoven looks like they didn't buy a weapon unless that's a visual glitch. It's going to be kind of difficult for this Killjoy to do much with a classic.
Yeah, just, well, maybe a little bit clutch. You never know. One shot, all it takes. Kind of. But we'll see if that works, or maybe just running around with a pistol out.
Yeah, Bruce is holding bathrooms with an operator, so if Springfield wants to push out, they're going to have to use utility. You don't want to dry peek when you know the enemy players are playing with an operator. The Molly goes out, is going to slow down aggressive a little bit with the Blear, does shoot it down. Jellies comes out, one taps Crinstar, making it a 5v4. Really well played by Jellies. That was a run of aggressive front attack. Aggressive act gets their operator too. It's now a 5v3. The Sova ultimate coming out, the Hunter's Fury not quite landing.
Oh, and that's all she wrote. They found it again. Jellies and aggressive taking out the 2 first frags, and the rest crumbles after Minnesota and Altoven having to hold. I mean, Altoven, no, that's actually, he just didn't buy. What?
That's so unfortunate for Altoven. You can't be making mistakes like that on match point. He's going to get punished for it as Tiki gets the last frag, a flawless round to give Springfield the victory.
Oh, that feels rough, right? And again, I have to say, it was a drastic change from map one. Beautiful attacking on both sides and aggressive and jizz. I really have to give huge accommodations for that, because you can see it 32 and 12 and 19 and 12. Fantastic freaking score lines for both of them. You saw the tag team play. Anytime the run it up was up, aggressive, playing on the namesake, constantly moving forward. And again, average combat score of 405, leagues above anyone else in this map.
Yeah, really impressive play out of Aggressive Act and Jelly's the double duelist, really holding down the offensive side, coming out of Springfield, really well played. This now means that Springfield gets their first win of the official league. They'd already beaten Dartmouth before in the preseason, and they continue to assert their dominance over that team now.
Yeah, and not only that, it's a 2-0, right? That always feels good, and now Dartmouth have got to go back to the drawing board. Looking at a lot of these plays, you have to emulate what you did on Bind on other maps, right? I love seeing the flip in how you decide to play. Defender on Ascent was great. You were able to hold it just like a lot of people say, pretty much by the manual. But emulate that same style of aggressive, upfront nature in your other maps now that you had on Bind. You won 6 rounds on that attacker side. Same as, you know, Springfield. They did the exact same thing, except maybe a little bit better. But overall, you see glimmers of hope. Hopefully you can keep capitalizing on that, as well as cleaning up some of your micro, you know, some of your aim and some of your corner chess.
Yeah, both teams had both teams had some really good gameplay, but it will be interesting to see how they continue to develop as the league progresses on.
Yep, and with that, we will go ahead and close out here for this series, but don't go anywhere. We'll be coming up here with a little quick change to our 7 o'clock match. It will be North Alabama versus Upper Iowa next, so please go ahead, stay tuned as we get everything transferred over. Thank you so much for tuning in for this first match.
All right, so everybody sees Vincent there. I can already tell you what agent Vincent plays in the game, right? Vincent? Sounds like venison.
Talking. I'll also get a little bit louder when I cast.
Thank you.
All right. And welcome here for series number two. Again, we had a quick change in the schedule. We are actually casting Upper Iowa versus North Alabama here in the Emergence League once again. We are going to have a fantastic time. And now I have Vincent joining me here on the broadcast. Vincent, how you doing, my man?
I'm doing well. You know, this is an exciting matchup because, listen, Upper Iowa, they are going to be able to be on stream for their debut. Never playing in an official match, not taking part in the preseason, and so Upper Iowa, we get to see what they have to offer here as well. North Alabama, they are coming in with a loss, to be fair, but you know what? That's week one. We're not worried about week one. We're worried about week two right now, and it's time to see what North Alabama can bring. Maybe I'll try not to let my Southern biases show. I'm a Georgia boy, so you know how it goes down here in the SEC type conference. It's just like, you know, we're all one basically.
Yep, keep digging that hole a little bit deeper each time, yep. My man. I did it earlier. Don't worry, my producer's mad at me, so we'll see what happens. But let's go ahead and talk about some of these maps because I'm very, very excited. So far, throughout most of the stream matches, we've seen pretty much the same thing: Ascent, Split, Haven. Right? We just had Bind, I believe. But for the first time, at least in my casting so far, we actually get Icebox, which was one of the newer maps released. I mean, Vincent, this map, what do you know about it? Do you like it? Do you hate it? What's up with it?
All right. So I feel like no matter what, like you just teed me up. You're like, you told me to keep on digging, and then you teed me up by... like other things. I appreciate that, Orbital. No matter how I answer, I'm just screwed. But I will give an honest answer. I think that this map is not that great to play, honestly. I don't love the design. That being said, it is absolutely amazing to watch as a commentator because there is a lot of craziness that can go down. There's also a lot of really interesting strategy on this map because of how insane the map is. So, like, even though, you know, on the base level, I'm like, oh yeah, this is like not a super well-designed map. I love the innovation that's available to players, and I really enjoy watching that happen in real time. And I think we have been watching that happen in real time, especially like at the pro level in the last like couple of months in particular. So I'm really curious to see what sort of preparations either of these teams have put into Icebox, or if it's just kind of a let's roll in there and brawl it out, shoot the heads as well as we can.
Yeah, and what's crazy is, you know, looking at some of the statistics coming out of it. Sorry, I just stumbled over my words there. Icebox sitting pretty at pretty much a dead even in terms of attack round win percentage and defender, right? So even though I do agree, it's one of the most poorly designed maps, very rough around some of the edges. It does allow both sides to have that advantage, right? And so, and now I'm gonna throw you a Bobcat now. You know, is there one side that you do see has some of those advantages? Because I got some spicy news for you. For this first map, we do have North Alabama coming out on the attacking side and Upper Iowa on the defending side first. And that's actually going to trend all the way through all three maps if all three are played.
Yeah, which is kind of interesting, honestly, that we see that. Don't typically see that sort of consistency over a best of three. But all of that said, for me, it's really hard to say what is the more ideal starting position. I think by my default position to that is always typically going to be the defensive side, simply because you don't have to worry about like out tricking your opponents necessarily, just rotating correctly, which can be hard in and of itself. But I think that as the offense on this map, there's a lot put on to you in order of trying to create opportunities to get into the site, especially over towards A, because it's very much defender-sided at that A site, at least initially. So for me, I think it edges towards the defense, but it really is going to come down to how these two teams elect to play it out.
Yeah, and again, this is the week one of the brand new patch, day one. Pretty much. So some teams have had a little practice with the Reyna changes. Seen a lot of people actually still take Reyna, but this time, no Reyna in sight. Zero, none, nada.
Yeah, those patch notes kind of hit me out of nowhere, to be honest with you. I was like, oh, cool. So we're not going to have like 10 frenzies every single pistol round. I love that. Well, maybe we still will. Who knows? I haven't seen it play out. The goal, I think, was that we don't have 10 frenzies every pistol round. But in general, I think that these changes are going to be positive. And like you said, no rain is on board, though we do see a Viper and a Viper on one side, a Sage on the other. So Upper Iowa going for the Sage. I think Sage is very strong right here, particularly on A on the defense. But then the Viper, I think, is strong on both sides. And if you get effective usage out of that wall, it can be huge.
Yeah, we're going to have to keep track and see if they can pull it off. Again, it is very quiet as we get started. Again, Krupp deciding he is going to quickly jump his way on top and get a little bit of a weaker advantage. As that is a full A push coming out on the attacker side. They are pushing directly in, hoping to secure a quick play, and they do. No shots pretty much fired right now. They are going a little bit ham in the crossfire. A lot of smoke's going out, and hopefully some health bars depleted. Couple shots. Squib deciding the shotgun to sawed off was the route to go. And Tonini says, I got this 2K for himself.
Yeah, and that's exactly why that Viper can be so strong here on this map. Really doing a good job of just splitting off the site, making it difficult to do anything if you are a defender. But now Retake has to come through. Paranoia there, but a little bit late. And so Jay Introvert is going to win that battle. And the next, Grubstore falling. And so, well, a lot of low health there for the offense. But it still is going to be North Alabama taking that first round in this half.
I mean, you also kind of expect some early game shenanigans with the pistol rounds. Pistol rounds always get a little bit wonky, in my opinion. You know, just one shot changes everything. Shotgun definitely changes quite a bit. And we already see the Marshall coming out with some SMGs, pushing out some funky stuff.
Well, and I mean, to be fair, I'm curious to see how these stingers will work out, considering, they're now the Nerf stingers, right? That Marshall, though, definitely could be interesting. Close range battle happening, but Lawrence is not going to be winning that one out. And see Tony going to be winning things that way. So a two-player advantage as the attackers are fully onto the B site.
Yeah, and I feel they kind of realize these are all silenced pistols right now. You can't do too much except for that. Anderson completely proving me wrong, and then Squib grabbing it right back. 3-on-2. Make that a 2-on... still 2-on-3. Spike has been planted, of course, and right out in the open. Very nice planting spot. These defenders can't rightly push in us with the wish. Ooh, good crossfire.
Well, and we see the effectiveness of this Viper trying to defend. We saw the Viper's pit come through, and then... Whoa, that was unfortunate. Oh... Anderson, nice to find one, but we saw the the Viper Mollies come through along with the Toxic Cloud and the wall. Like, there's just so much that you have to contend with, once you're on that site trying to retake it. That's where the Viper can be very effective on Icebox. And so my eyes definitely on the Viper, on Shiflo in particular. How much value are you going to be getting out of that?
Yeah, and it's such a good deterrent, right? I love seeing the crowd control and some of that kind of fluctuation that can be used when laying down a lot of those abilities and ensuring that the site that you choose should have cover. But Squib says the best cover is no cover and immediately drops Anderson. Next one coming through might be another pick, but that's another hard push in. Very quick by this North Alabama squad. They're saying we ain't playing around.
Well, and Squib, I mean, that's the problem. You swing around that wall and you run into like three players just staring at you. Squib closing things out with another kill. That's three in the round for Squib, leaving Krupster to defend for themselves now in a difficult spot. Not even going to be able to pick up that one frag. So 3-0, flawless start right now for the North Alabama side as they have they've taken off. And I really have been impressed here with these first couple of rounds.
Upper Iowa having a few issues here, possibly finding even their footing, right? This is a very difficult time. You lost three rounds in a row, and you're still semi-ecoing here. Three SMGs laid out versus four Vandals, and I believe that is still the Marshall coming out. So, gonna be an uphill battle. At least this time, you have full armor.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's going to be the key. And, well, SMGs, those are now actually Spectres. No longer Singers, right? You've seen the evolution already. It's begun as pipe control has been gained now for the offense.
Yep. And this is, oh, the hard move around straight into B. They're going to find one. Omen Corrupt says, guys, I might need some help, and immediately backside out, but get caught. Oh, that was a good catch. Sushi Rice takes out Atlantic Ghost. It's going to be a quick draw into a 4-on-4, but Clarence says, I want to make it 3. We are getting our first round win. Squib might have something to say about that, though.
Yeah, Clarence just going to be throwing out those slow orbs, hoping to stop any of those attackers, but it is not going to be enough because Squib takes that headshot, and it is now just 2 defenders left, and they, well, make it 1. They're stuck in a difficult spot here in the middle area. Now that flash giving away Anderson's position, and so not going to be missing the shot. So, a 4-0 start here for the attackers. This is exactly what I wanted to see, the exact type of start that the attackers really need to kind of establish themselves.
Yeah, and so far, all of these plants and takes have been before I feel a minute has passed, and I think that speaks a lot to the mentality currently coming out of North Alabama. They understand that they can push it a little bit more, and they are definitely reaching. Like, this is kind of like the testing point, right? Test your opponents. You haven't played against them before, and why not push the tempo? Why not see how far you go with these constant holds, and finally with the realization that the defenders have a couple vandals on there, one or two, they're going to be a little bit careful. Never mind.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, that's just unfortunate, right? Squib, or rather Shiploh, my apologies, in just prime positioning to just punish the push coming through there from Krupster, and who is having a little bit of a rough start. No frags on the board just yet. And, well, Clarence is going to be the sole player in defense of the B site. Not quite been spotted out just yet as the rest of the attackers come through. North Alabama need to suss it out, but the plant coming in doesn't find it, but he doesn't know about Atlantic Coast in the back line. And that's going to be the 1-for-1. So 4-on-2 as the retake needs to be perfect.
Yeah, this is going to be a tall order. You got a Phoenix, and I believe Killjoy on that side. That's just not going to work as Sushi Rice gets dropped as the last frag of the round. And again, 5-0 to North Alabama. They are playing this one up.
I mean, this just looks to me, and I mean, no disrespect, of course, to Upper Iowa, but this just looks to me like they know this map much better. North Alabama, they know they have plans. They've practiced this significantly. Whereas, you know, Upper Iowa, they have, you know, maybe had a scrim or two, but haven't really had enough time to really define how their defense plays out, especially as, I mean, they're still like, they're half buying like every single round. And I don't know that I love that coming through from them.
Yeah, what's crazy is Upper Iowa chose this map. They chose to be on the defensive side, and yet they are having this much trouble kind of turning it over. And I think that is a very ample point to make as we are now into the rounds, and Tonini said, nah, I'm bringing out the big gun here in this match. That's gonna be a quick 2 drop as they already have the plant. I mean, this is looking like a wash.
I mean, well, oh, that's so unfortunate. Anderson had actually a pretty good angle. I mean, dropped at the right time too. Had no way of knowing that, but still did well, and it didn't matter. There was one player looking his direction regardless, and a 1-for-1 trade. Atlantico is cleaning things up to 6-0 lead, and honestly, I hate to say it, Orbital, but I don't necessarily see this changing, because it's really just been, you know, site take after site take, and it's just been a solid.
Yeah, this is everything that the side of Upper Iowa have tried to do has fallen flat. And I mean, I think this is one of the rare times that I've seen all 5 ultimates available, right? Yeah. Usually at least 1 or 2 have been used in prep or used around before, so you can offset, right? You always have that ultimate advantage. And likewise, on the other side, 4 ultimates up. But that hurts, right? If I don't see any of these ultimates expended, if I don't see any of these resources expended either, this utility, that's a problem. God, that's
That's just, you know, really great shooting coming through here for the attackers. I mean, it's just been very, very strong all the way around. But that kind of kill really just shows where they've been at throughout this game thus far. And it's been the strategy winning out in the end. Now it's just a 2-on-5. Well, that's a 2-on, or rather a 1-on-5 now. As Krupster, you're going to have to be rotating in. And I will say, another thing that I notice here, Orbital, we see the consistent investment of cash into the SMGs basically every round for the defense. I have to wonder if that is the right decision. What are your thoughts?
I hate it. I'm going to come outright and just say it. I love SMGs if you are having to stifle the eco, right? Like, you can't afford to eco, and you just got to get one of those primaries. However, SMGs are a weak buy-up point, right? Like, you have to understand that. Constantly sinking money is just shortchanging yourself each time. Yes, you will accrue some sort of econ later if you keep doing it, but that's multi-rounds later than if you just hard ecos, took a pistol loss, and said, okay, now we come back 2 rounds later. You have the loser's bonus. Utilize that, right? Don't keep sinking money. Don't keep sinking this vast amount of money into this hold when you know the opponents have these broader guns, have these primary assault rifles, and are just crushing you time and time again.
Yeah, I really fully agree with every sentiment that you just put forth there. You really cannot continue investing in those, well, not ideal weapons. And so we just keep seeing that time and time again. And already, that first frag going the way of the offense as they sneak their way out onto B. Good shooting, but not quite connecting there from Squib. Gets tagged down pretty heavily as well. So still, like you said, 4 ultimates here available online. So definitely not a bad position for the defense by chance, but well, that certainly was a bad position. Clarence getting punished for the over rotation, and now this B side is open, but it is an A plant that is on.
Squib, I think, is gonna find a few. Yeah, this is that's so painful, right? You can see Killjoy, Sage both still have their ultimates up, and I think that's 2 rounds now that they sat on that. You have to start thinking, how can I start utilizing these tools in my pocket? You keep getting flanked, you keep getting picked, and yes, this is on North Alabama for having fantastic gun control. Like, no matter what, at the end of the day, this is still an FPS, right? This is still a shooter game, first-person shooter, and they are playing it like
do they die?
Team. But
do they
are
die
they?
Here? Oh, they do! Oh no, that's devastating! Oh, Upper Iowa, just a massive mistake right there. You know, I like the decision to save, right? It wasn't a bad decision to save, but you gotta, that's just map knowledge. And this kind of goes back to what I was saying, that I just kind of feel like North Alabama knows this map a lot better.
Yeah, and one of the harshest realities for all that we started talking about Upper Iowa, right? There is a point where there is forced errors and there are unforced errors. Unforced errors being basically errors, mistakes, or problems that occur that that are not because of the opponent's play, that are not because the opponent's play. And so there, I feel a lot of this is coming down to forced errors. Basically, North Alabama playing exceedingly well. That will always accentuate massive issues that come out in certain plays, right? That will accent these cracks in the armor of Upper Iowa just like that. And again, on their map pick, they are having this much complications. I'm terrified to see what happens on Ascent.
I think you took the words right out of my mouth about the terrified about me and what's going to happen on Ascent, because this, I mean, it really just looks like we're seeing a difference in some fundamentals, especially. That, though, nice kill from Clarence to pick that one up. So a man advantage now available, and a second one for Anderson. This is the round. Remember, this is where there was really an investment coming through, and now all of the knives, those daggers missing. It's 1-on-3. Shiflo going to have to pull out a miracle here against 2 now.
Well, a couple shots didn't make it, and there you go, round. The first round in the 9th hour, they are able to pick it up. Upper Iowa showing some signs of life after taking our advice, throwing away the SMGs and going for the Vandals. That's all we needed.
Yeah, exactly. I was getting to it, but then it was the kills. You know, they finally invested those rifles. They got an Ares out. They got, you know, the full rifles available otherwise, and it worked to perfection. So, great adjustment there coming through from Upper Iowa. North Alabama, honestly, they just need to continue doing what they've been doing because that is, it seems as if that might just be a shot in the pan, at least thus far. Upper Iowa need to maybe try and turn this into a couple extra rounds if we realistically want to see a comeback.
Yeah, and I like it. You can see multiple full rifles coming out. Yes, that's another full rifle buy from the side of North Alabama as well. But you can see the tempo maybe slowing down. Nope, they don't care. Never mind. I lied. It's still a fast push. Couple good grabs. Krupp with a very nice position. Trades it one for one. That's still going to be T-Tonini and Atlantic Coast grabbing two more of their own. Or one more, I'm very sorry, as that is going to be a 4-on-3 in favor of North Alabama with the plant.
Yeah, and that's a very nice lockdown, though, from the defense. Doing the right thing. And through the wall there, Clarence wins out. Hunter's Fury coming through, trying to deny some space. But it turns into just the 1v1. That Hunter's Fury from Tonini in the back. And that sonar dart should find some information. Don't know if it tagged anyone, or rather tagged the Killjoy. But remember that Killjoy Sushi Rice, 5 health available. And that makes things so difficult.
If he gets zapped to death, I'm going to laugh. that would be like the worst feeling ever. Like, obviously you can't see how much health there is, but I would hate myself if that happened to me.
It would be devastating. Let's just be honest. I mean, I would cry and I might quit just gaming entirely. So I think Sushi Rice feeling the same, just saves. Doesn't want any part of that.
It reminds me so much of and I feel bad for bringing it up, of course, watching Valorant, but CS:GO dinks, watching grenades hit someone or in Halo, it's just like it's embarrassing. It's the worst feeling you can ever have, just watching something that shouldn't kill you, and you're just like, no, that's not how that's supposed to work. No, and then you're put on some highlight reel on YouTube, and then you just it's immortalized at that point.
Yeah, you just cry because you just got killed. You got killed by a flashbang, not from the explosion of it, by just getting hit in the face with it. Somebody tossed it at you. But yeah, no, you're right. Absolutely. so frustrating.
I'm making myself laugh too much. We are in to round number 10 or 11. I'm very sorry. One round from half afterwards. And that is going to be the all important one because I would like to see Upper Iowa still grab at least one more round out of this defense, right? You want to see them show some signs of life, show that they can grab a bit more. And Massacre, why is he still? He has 3,300 in the bank and he decides not to. Big jump back and see Tonini makes the power play with the jet on his assist. And Clarence says, not anymore.
It's a very nice frag with that Bucky in there, finally using that resurrect. Better late than never, right, Clarence?
Yeah.
Good position. Oh, that's another. Make it two. The Bucky, so powerful. Doing incredibly well in recovering a rifle. So maybe we can see Massacre come recover that. Oh, it has recovered an operator, actually. So a bigger gun.
You know what? If one bullet doesn't hit, just send 10 and hopefully 5 of them hit. That's the game plan. Krupster said, hey, I can do it too. Drops 2, forces it into a 1v3. So not exactly what you would hope, but it looks like Anderson is going to simply soak that damage. Is he going to get it? Yeah, I think he's got it pretty easily.
Yeah.
But Krupster, I like that show of signs of life. Very nice 2K.
Last round before
even,
the switch.
Even at the very end.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, yeah, that I was mean... actually them. I'm very sorry. Never mind. My brain was somewhere else. Very nice by Upper Iowa.
We're fine, guys. It's fine.
The early, just what is that? I think 8 rounds just kind of did me a doozy, I think.
Yeah, you know, that's fair enough. It was kind of the fastest 8 rounds I've seen in Valorant in a while. So, you know, fair enough. It definitely can hit you fast. But we are into the last round before the switch. And it is guns for both sides. Once more, operator. Ooh. That's Sushi Rice, an opening frag. You love to see that. But James Travert is going to be finding a return frag elsewhere. And so now a 4-on-4.
Oh, you got that. That is an awesome way to start off this last round. right? Big confidence boost moving in. Grab that pick and say, no, we are still here. We are still going to play. And I love that hold straight through the mid. But now you can see the slow, a possible rotate over to B, but a very nice Viper wall going up. So sectioning off what they can possibly do.
Well, and the Viper's coming through. That is going to cut off some of this area and a very exposed plant because of that. So even if this the Viper goes down, you're in a tough spot with this smoke. Well, speaking of which, that's two players inside and immediately sending back the run it back. And that is Frags, just a flurry of them going the way of North Alabama. And, well, Squib, that's another one. Now it's just Sushi Rights who opened the round, now might close the round as it is the bookends.
Yeah, oh, can't get the quick silk off as Jintrovert picks up a 3K to end that half, 8-5-4. Now back into the pistols, it is going to be North Alabama pulling off, I believe, a little bit. Have some fun now as we are getting right back into the action.
Yeah, I mean, they are going with the full classics plus armor, with the exception of Squib, who has just cheekily invested into the shorty, which, you know, that's so fun. Playing close range with that thing, looks like he's over towards A. That's exactly where you want to be. On the other side, though, it's going to be a little bit more variety. Ghosts for some, classics for others, and not a lot of armor to speak of, so that shorty is going to be very effective close range.
Yeah, and I wonder if North Alabama are actually going to play super aggressive on the defender side, and it looks like they are. You can see on the bottom side of that mini-map pushing up from that B site and trying a flank. So we'll see if they can make it in time. Two quick shotty shots, doesn't get the kill as Squib watches his teammate die. That's going to be a 1-for-1 trade of frag. And a couple more shots to find some damage, but no kills. Masker, happy about getting that headshot.
That was a very nice headshot on the jumping jet. I mean, that's a hard shot to hit. Let's be real about it. So now 4v3, the retake on coming. But, I was going to mention the flake from Tonini, but that is immediately shut down. Clarence winning that out, so 2-on-4. This retake needs to be impeccable.
Yeah, and looks to not be. As that is going to be a trade 1-for-1, and now attackers have a 2-man advantage. More like 2.5 as Soda's health is very low. Nice couple shots from Shift. We'll have to do that one more time. Yeah, gets two. Very nice headshot. Starts the defuse. One running around. One more. Is he going to get it? No! Can't do it. Shiflo almost coming out with the epic win. At least drop the Krupster on the end.
He was looking for the right click right there. Oh, man. He wanted it big time, but not quite enough. And, well, that is a great stabilization. I mean, listen, it's still... I don't want to be too crazy because it is still 10-3. But that pistol round certainly something that was necessary for Upper Iowa to kind of bring themselves back into this game. And I think that they're now in prime position to start to take things away. What I will say is that I'm not loving the full ghost second round. This, is a bit of a blast from the past. We used to see this pretty often back in the pro meta, maybe like last year, 7 months ago. But there's a reason why this has kind of fallen by the wayside. I think they're lucky that there's only classics on the other side.
Yeah, this is a... It feels like an eco versus eco here as Air Anderson again picks it up. So the ghost so far working out, yes, it was a gamble to see if it would work. But, I mean, a gamble is a gamble, and they're raking in the pot so far as Atlanticos says no more of your shenanigans. Top Fragger Clarence is out.
Well, that is a little bit short-lived. Anderson going to be winning that duel. Shiflo does pick up one on the return, but each of these kills is worth less because of the fact that there was so limited investment. Normally you're like 3 kills with classics. That's great. But then you realize that it was only against ghosts and that's not as amazing. So still plenty of cash available and it's going to be the full investment. Not quite sure what was happening there on the first half, but now the buys for Upper Iowa seem to be very coordinated, very consistent, and I've loved their adjustment. This is probably one of the fastest adjustments that I've seen from a team in a while.
Yeah, and not only that, though, I have to commend North Alabama, right? Because this is the right call. You eco that second round loss, and you just take the hit. Now you have a full buy. You're not going to be dropping 8 rounds in a row. I do not foresee them dropping 8 rounds in a row, even if the fundamentals we talked about earlier were not so even, right? If they were even, this is still the right move. Now they have a full buy versus full buy, and Upper Iowa are going to be a little bit surprised, I think. A nice little flash there. Spite over the side, Citolini.
Oh!
Thank you. I will take 2, possibly 3. That's an answered headshot. 4 headshots in the round alone. Nasty aim coming out now.
Tonini. Wham, bam. Ooh. Thank you, ma'am. And it is a 1-2 smacked. It's just Clarence, who is the top frag for this Upper Iowa side. It's been playing very well. 11-13 right now, leading the leaderboard for their team. But this is a difficult one, especially as Squid comes around the corner. Is going to be the frag, though. Clarence winning that one out. Great crosshair placement as well. So just 3 more left to find, but Shiflo is now on site, and all that utility is available.
Left. Yeah, let's hope he can get it down. No, is revealed by the spy cam, so they know exactly what's going on and can't get that extra one. I mean, valiant attempts coming out here, and I mean, what can you do against 3? I think that's about as best you can get. Still, like I said, already dropping in, and now they have to eco. But
that's a little questionable. Well, okay. Okay. Listen. Orbital, I think that I will defend. Okay, never mind. Listen. I was thinking that they were going to do the half investment and be like, listen, we'll let you have the round 12, and we'll fight it back. You know, 8 rounds in a row, go to overtime, we win it out. I would have appreciated the sheer power of will if that's what we had seen. But unfortunately, there's such a large investment. I can't really see them getting anything better than this by in the next round. And it's just a little questionable.
Yeah, that's gonna... I feel that's gonna be... Oh my gosh. No words can describe what just happened here. That was...
Well, I mean, I think maybe like a word, like and domination, maybe?
Yeah. That is the fastest I think I've seen a team turn a corner and then just straight lose all their lives. That was almost like a bomb just exploded in their face and just took all their lives. So very well done by North Alabama to immediately shut it down. And now they're forced into just what I feel like is a terrible buy setup.
I mean, I don't really think that your feelings have anything to do with it. I think this is just objectively a bad buy. like, yeah, the Ares is doable. The Bulldog is okay. Like, these aren't the worst weapons, but they're not ideal by any means. And so, especially going up against 5 Vandals with that one-shot potential, can be pretty brutal.
Yeah, and now they're trying to slow down the tempo, and unfortunately, it's a little too little too late, right? You are slowing it down. You're waiting to try and get some information and possibly get that 1 or 2 frag to open up one of the sites. But you're facing off, I feel, against a Cypher who will easily negate a lot of those attempts, right? You have a Cypher that can cover a lot of ground very, very simply. So yeah, you see the full rotate over straight through kitchen and hall into B. They are allowed to do this because they have the cans up from Cypher, because they're able to securely hold that area and be able to rotate quickly. So we'll see if Upper Iowa can create a miracle here.
Well, running back comes through there for Upper Iowa. Not going to be finding much of anything. Anderson gets it back. That second duel not going their way either, nor the third. That being said, though, Clarence does eventually get that frag on to Nini, I believe. As now, that's a very good resurrection. Oh, but not quite. quite enough to bring them over the edge. The exposed Rez not doing the necessary deeds to pick up that round. And so North Alabama, they take that in what is, on both on paper and in reality, a very dominant fashion. 13-4, the final score. And I think that definitely does communicate where Iowa was in this game. They just were struggling a little bit.
Yeah, and I think part of that came out of frustration, to be honest. And I said that a lot, right? I don't like harping on teams very much, but there are some points that kind of need to be said, right? That 8-round streak of wins felt like it just broke their spirits, right? The constant buy of SMGs, even though it is a primary, technically, these are half primaries, in my opinion. They don't do as much damage, low range impact, and you really have to get your money's worth. And they did that for 4 rounds in a row before they were able to find a round win. They have got to steal their mental if they want to be able to find a way to come back in a lot of these matches where you have that opportunity to kind of reset, right? After a round, take a breather, take a breath in, maybe look at the game at a different angle.
Yeah. Yeah, well, with that, I think we are going to be heading to a little bit of a break, but I think this is the opportunity. This is where the coach, the dad bod god himself, Jim, can fellow caster as well, can really step up, can tell Upper Iowa, listen, here's what needs to happen. Here's the adjustments that need to be made as we move into Ascent. So we're going to allow for him to do just that. And whilst he's doing that, we'll take a quick little break. We'll be right back with you with more Valorant action right after this.
Thank you.
And welcome back. After that short break, we are here for map number two between North Alabama and Upper Iowa University. Again, in their debut match, of course, having a little bit of a rough time, taking Icebox and falling in, I believe, 13-3 was the map score, or 13-4, I believe.
Four.
Either way, North Alabama showing up pretty much big time here, making sure that they don't go 0-2 in the first 2 weeks.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest. I do think that there is very little chance that this is anything but a 2-0 for North Alabama. That being said, I think what I'm looking out for here moving towards Ascent, which is North Alabama's pick, are a couple of things for Upper Iowa. Number one, adjustments. I want to see kind of where, what that mid-round, that mid-round, not really accurate, mid-BO3 adjustment from the coaching staff can bring out. You can only do so much, but I think that there, we had enough time where you could have had a conversation, and we'll see how that goes. And on top of that, I just think, North Alabama, they looked so very strong, really looking good in this matchup thus far. And I'm wanting to see, like, if that was their icebox strategies, I'm really looking to see what they bring on a more normal map, something that we see much more often, like Ascent. So,
yeah, just that, icebox is one of those that people still kind of shift away from, kind of don't want to see that anymore. But Ascent, of course, we saw it in Series 1, and this time around, it will actually be North Alabama's choice. So they actually opted for this map. Now, they got stuck with the defense side first, I believe. No, attacking side first. Very sorry. And, again, utilization of a lot of the utility and abilities, but straight up, awesome fragging coming out. You saw really good marksmanship coming out from everyone. That's why they had three members all sitting, I think, at 18, 17, and 17. In the frags, just in that first map.
Yeah, exactly. Pretty consistent fragging across the board there for North Alabama. Something that was quite impressive in that first map. And moving forward, I hope we see yet more of. Again, we are seeing Sushi Rice on the Reyna, which, now nerfed. I will be interested to see how that works out. On the other side, though, a pretty meta-like composition, I have to be honest, with some key exceptions, being that you don't necessarily always see the raise here on the Ascent. You also don't necessarily see the Brimstone that Atlanticus is playing. That is usually going to be an omen here, but I think Brimstone works just fine.
Yeah, Brimstone bringing some of the pain. Saw it last time, I think, for a little bit. And now coming back out and mirrored Brimstones. And I think that's the only mirror that we see here. Surprisingly enough, only one Sova. Usually you see Sovas on both. The information that a Sova can bring is huge. Instead, opting for that duo on what I like to call Never Dying Squad. The Sage and Phoenix both having some fun there.
Well, and the double smokes, very interesting composition. We'll see how those work out here for the defense. If you commit those in one position, you pretty much just have infinite smokes forever. So it could be interesting. A nice little boost pack to get the Rays into position, but Atlanticus wins that opening duel as Krupster, trying to run through the smoke, does not get anything done. Now on the site, Gentrovert going to be winning that out. So 3-on-5 here for the defense.
That immediate plant once again. North Alabama taking no time resetting and making sure they are up to date with this. A hard flank coming about from B Lobby into the main. Looks like it is just shut down. Stands. This is going to be round one going the way of North Alabama, the one of many, as Vincent, you so rightfully pointed out.
Yeah, I mean, a first round that looked very strong, flawless, in fact, for North Alabama there. And it is going to be a bit of an investment, actually. Not really a save coming in with those ghosts. About $1,000 left in the bank for each player of the defense up for Iowa. Right, going here for maybe a bit of a different strategy. Looking for the armor, even without investing much with regarding the weaponry. So five players over towards A, It looks like it's going to be a pretty quick A take from how they're setting it up.
Yeah, an immediate push. You can actually see right in mid-courtyard, that was a two-man flank attempt, but that still leaves exposed A site. So that's going to be a very quick plant with a minute 20 still left on the clock before they actually need to do anything. So a heavy move in as Squib goes ahead and grabs one. That might be a second as, yeah, beautiful through the wall shot as Krupp finally shuts down the jet.
Yeah, man, but it was a two-for-one trade. Not ideal. Oh. And those paint shells, beautiful. Gentrovert going to be closing out one, make it two. And Atlanticos going to be closing the round out in the favor of North Alabama. So not quite flawless this time, Orbital, but close enough as it is a two-round advantage now for North Alabama.
Yeah, now here is where it gets tricky, right? At this point, last time, we saw a lot of SMGs coming out on the side of Upper Iowa. And I want to see them save just one more time, stock up. They only picked up armor, it looks like, very minor sets. And it looks like it. So they sold the weapons. I think this might actually be an eco round.
Yeah. I mean, it looks like it. But I don't know if I love the investment of armor with just a classic. But I think this is stepping in the right direction. Very much so. So all things considered, not too shabby at all for Upper Iowa as they, again, get aggressive towards mid. This time things going to be going a little bit slower. Still, most of the attacker is grouped up towards A, but two of those are just trying to suss things out towards mid, looking for a push, waiting for any sort of aggression, and they are not finding much of anything at all. The Soviet and the Jet on the extremities thinking, well, I guess let's just wait, and now we go.
Oh, yep, you called it exactly as the sheriff finds a mark. That's going to be two sheriffs deciding the two first frags and a couple of stingers on the side in case Krupp, Claw, Prince, and Anderson decide to get frisky.
I love how you had Clawrence right there. It was beautiful.
Not the best on my end, but that is going to be a nice take. See Tonini again falling. First death of this map, so hopefully not too many on his end, but still very calm. It feels calculated play coming out of North Alabama, but this time Upper Iowa, no more SMGs, no more stingers or specters, finally throwing in the big haymakers, vandals, almost across the board.
Indeed, and you know, Krupster could have got an operator out, in fact, too. Didn't really want to get that one through. Understandable. I do definitely get that. So some smoke's coming through here at top mid, just trying to get some control, and unfortunately not quite realizing that that does not cover all of mid if you put it right into the middle. I know, because I have done exactly that before, and it's very sad. But yeah, two opening frags. Lawrence now gonna need to be the big player, but doesn't end up hitting the shot, and Tonini following up onto Krupster leaves Anderson in a 1-on-5.
Just a little bit getting caught with their pants down, and so far North Alabama just showing excellent micro mechanics, showing excellent aim and just well-placed movements. I feel this has been almost a, if this weren't the emergence division, I would assume they were probably higher rank, all right, with just how clean they look. It feels that there's not a whole lot of wasted movement. Maybe that's just a confidence speaking from them. But it definitely feels that they have the full no around, even here on Ascent, this map they have picked, and possibly might just run the whole first half.
I mean, if those first couple of rounds are anything to go by, they definitely could start to run away with things. That being said, though, from pretty heavy mid pressure right now for the defense, they got, you know, kind of wrecked over there in the last round, so wanting to make sure that doesn't happen, and indeed, a 2-for-1 kill. Massacre winning things out in mid, so that's perfectly done. That does say, hey, well, there's a lot mid, let's go A for the offense as they move through 3-on-4 in the favor of the defense.
Yeah, for the first time they have the man advantage as the spike goes down, and immediately double smoke to push out those rafters, and Shiplow sniffs it out. Anderson taking one and dealing one. 2-on-2 left with Omen, Cypher, and double Brimstone.
And Brimstone, the key here on the flank, needs to get in quickly, though. This is starting to take a little bit too long. Now in, but it's going to get taken down. Massacre was the hero in mid, but can't be the hero at A, as Atlanticus closing things out with a triple kill. Puts a fifth on the board now for North Alabama.
Yeah, and honestly, the thought, I think, there from Upper Iowa is actually pretty good. If they had both flanked at the same time, I think in Rafters, I think we saw just a little cheat about half a second late. It was good in theory, though. Very nice flank attempt, draw the attention, possibly get the exit frags as well. So they're getting closer, right? This is no longer flawless victories. These are starting to become a little bit irregular. Last one, four members dead. So maybe they get all five and are able to clinch around much earlier than an 8-round streak.
Yeah, though, you know, with the good comes the bad right now, because we are seeing back to the SMGs right now for Upper Iowa. Swinging out now on the site was Sushi Rice, but Shiflo wins that duel out pretty handedly. Run it back available there for the Phoenix in Heaven, but not quite utilized. The spike gets planted, and the defense of this site is looking indomitable 5-on-4 for North Alabama.
Yeah, just smokes being popped everywhere. I personally... Ouch! Sorry, I just don't think I've ever seen a body ragdoll that hard in the middle of a fight. So, well done on finding that pick, but Squib immediately grabs one. The Sage Wall in the bottom of the screen immediately pops as well. And that is going to be the snap on to Omen to finish off the round.
Really solid stuff. I mean, like I said, it was a 5-on-4 once they got onto the site. Just converting that effectively on the attack. And this is a slightly defender-sided map. I say slightly because it is very slight. But nonetheless, things can be going either way, I think, depending on the teams. And right now, that's North Alabama all the way around, no matter how you look at it. And it is a couple of rifles picked up now for the defense. Upper Iowa, though, they maybe need to start to try and clean that up a bit. They had the cash, just didn't choose to invest it in those rifles.
Deciding that they need to push a little bit and possibly losing their grip on this, on the mental game here again. We talk about it all the time, you know, when to eco, when not to eco.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, this is one of the times to try and turn around. Round six, a couple shots go off with as Shiflo grabs the first frag, second frag as well. Anderson able to grab Shiflo. Firefight breaking out here on the A site. Gonna draw a lot of attention from Sage and Omen.
Well, a lot of attention, yes, but is it going to be enough to net them the frags necessary? It is 2-on-4. Resurrect is available, but that is quickly shut down to Nini, with the operator able to pretty much deny that before it even begins, and Genfervert to clean things up. And it is just round after round at the moment going the way of North Alabama. We're all the way up to 7 orbital, and it doesn't look like it's stopping.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta love the Candy King. Gingervert having a blast here. I wonder. Okay, no. I was wondering. A crazy idea came in my head. I was gonna be like, hey, he's gonna go try for a knife round only. And I was like, please, no, that is not ever gonna happen. We do see 4 ultimates, though, coming out on the side of the defenders. Sage, Reyna, Phoenix, and Omen all having theirs up. So the resources and abilities to try and make a play happen. Let's see if we can turn.
Well, Massacre, the player, the sole player without the ultimate there for the defense, taken down early. So still lots of tools like you were talking about to deal with. But all players on the offense, North Alabama looking to get aggressive. Antonini wins that duel. Krupster going down. So 5-on-3 now. And it's going to be difficult. A good crossfire, but winning both the duels are the offense. So North Alabama move towards A. It's just Anderson who's got to be the sole player in defense of this site. Has a lot. Needs to get this flank lined up. And gets the first, but not much more. A little bit of a whiff shot allows for Atlanticos to take him out. A triple kill from Atlanticos in the round.
Yeah, and I just want to draw eyes back to that clearance under by the side of North Alabama. I think that's one of the cleaner entries that I've ever seen. You know, not having that ability to shoot your teammates as much, of course. But still, very clean entry, back-to-back, or front-to-front, if you will, in winning both those wars. Very, very nice job. Very nice coordination. And I'm excited to see them in the rest of the league as well, watching this North Alabama team. They lost their first series, second series here. It looks like it's going to be a watch of 2-0. As C. Tonini continuously picking up these first frags with that op in hand.
Well, Tonini sees him and knocks him down. That's what's happening right now, as it is already 5-on-3. I mean, I don't even know where that second frag went. Like, I don't even know where the second player died. That's how fast it came through. And Tonini.
Third.
Yep. Well, I know where that one was, but there's a resurrection. Sushi Rice going to be rezzed by Clarence, but Tonini is still holding down the sight lines, and this is looking nigh impossible.
Yeah, doors broken with a couple shots, but again, it is 3-on-5. Full health bars coming out on North Alabama as they start to slowly push away in. A quick grab as Clarence gets a nice little flank, but might meet his doom. Tags as it's just a sage wall, not going to be very useful. Gets a nice pick with that bulldog. He's going to get shot down where he stands. So got two nice frags, but lost his life in return.
And just solid trading there. I really do. I mean, maybe I'll speak too soon because, you know, we're not quite to the crazy rounds. But I do like that North Alabama is not really getting too insane. They're still playing, you know, very fundamentally, not trying to get cheeky with it yet. And, you know, I like that respect. That's really solid from North Alabama. And Upper Iowa, similarly, not giving up. Still much, as much as they're losing, definitely in this game, and giving it their best shot.
And I think they're, you know, it's rough to always say, and it always feels like a cop-out, is there's so much to learn in loss. There's so much to be able to go over, and there's so much to be able to go back and review those VODs, and I think this is one that I think they will definitely feel like it is okay to review, as we do get all five members of Defender side still alive. As not anymore. Squib says not today, as another right click takes the life. It might get three. There it is. This is the jet that you see in all the highlight reels. Three down, two to go.
McWright clicking their way to the top. Is Squib going to be having the opportunity for another? You're not going to be able to hit that, though. Old right click hits that, I feel. But, you know, that was like, can I say that anymore? That was like a long, long time ago. I'm showing how long I've been following this game since its inception. So, you know, a little bit of time. But yeah, just two players left trying to save their weaponry. Prupser, just barely getting away with their life. But a save nonetheless. But it's double-digit rounds to a big fat goose egg. And it is just really good for North Alabama all the way around, stepping things up massively.
Yeah, they've done very well. And again, the quicker that you end these, the faster you get to that victory screen. I think they're ready to go to end their night. 10-0. Spike on Cypher. So they're going to try and... Looks like a nice, decent spread this time. A little bit of a move towards the mid-courtyard. You really haven't seen much action there, and that's always surprising me, as that I always feel that mid-courtyard tends to be one of just high crossfire and a lot of chaos.
To be fair, early in the game, we did see it quite a bit, but then I think both teams just kind of realized, okay, well, we'll just give it up, you know, wait things out. But man advantage right now, Anderson with that opening frag, but that's quickly going to be responded to. Nini, operator in hand, continuing to find the frags where necessary, and the push comes through in that mid-courtyard that we were just talking about, but Clarence not going to be denied. The Bucky in hand, well placed, but caught out in the open. Starts 3-on-3.
That's gonna be making some fun as a shiplow drops two. Just as I was saying, there wasn't much action. Brings the action to the courtyard. That's gonna be, I believe, a B side plant. Once again, it is Arena in Phoenix, ready to attempt a retake.
I mean, this is This is definitely one of the better looking rounds on the retake, but you're going to have to get in much, much quicker. I mean, that spike's already ticking a little bit quickly. And, well, oh no. This is, I would say, a bad decision from Upper Iowa. I mean, yes, the chances of the retake are low, but you're down 10 to nothing. You really need to be going for these rounds when you can. Sure, you get an operator, but that really doesn't mean much of anything, as you just have one round left in the half and plenty of cash online anyway.
I feel it's more about the respect, right? You know, just maybe a little disrespect, like, nah, 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 I got your gun. Just kind of wave it in the opponent's face. But very correct here. 11-0. Two more rounds to win it all. One of them will be in the second half, of course. But
let's go.
A demonstration of sorts by this North Alabama squad. And we'll see if this is going to be a clean sweep, Sushi. All right, guess the op wasn't an awful pickup.
No, I mean, listen, the operator's really strong here on Ascent. I don't deny that, but, you know, it's still 11-0. So, like, you got to go for things when you can. And Odin here in the back corner, though, could be spelling destruction if we see the take come through. And it looks like we might, as those smokes go down, the sky smokes available. But as I say that, everyone looking to entirely just move out of A and rotate to maybe the B or mid area of the map here for the offense.
I'm curious. They're making their way all the way back through attacker spawn. And they're all walking, which I find absolutely glorious.
Hilarious.
Normally you don't see, okay, there you go. Now they're racing through.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I mean no disrespect, but if you're going to do a fake, you might want to move things a little bit quicker in order to, you know, facilitate the rotations. But listen, I can't deny what deny the results, right? They're being quite effective. The showstopper are coming through, and it is a 4-on-4 as well.
That's going to be Squib. Grab a masker on the back end. Very nice headshot for him. Spike has been planted. One round to change it all. Sushi Rice was able to grab one frag. Can he grab another? Another off shot goes off as Anderson is running interference. Run it back. Does close out with literally nothing to show for it. Arms on the other side. Trying to find it, but Mike gets off with that pick. Nope. Splatters off to nothingness.
Well, Clarence, that's unfortunate. Getting spammed out by Jen Trevert. Now is the sole player left. Is to win the duel, gets the spray whilst moving, but with 4 HP left, it's not going to be much more. So the flawless first half, North Alabama in prime position. They just need this pistol round. Now, granted, pistols have been where Upper Iowa have shown the brightest, winning two pistols. Didn't they win both pistols in an icebox?
Yeah, I believe so. They also ran a few extras. I think there was one on Icebox, but it was actually a second pistol round after the first in the second half, where they ran all ghosts and actually came out with a victory there. So it was very entertaining to watch, and I don't know if we'll see it again here, but if we do, I think that's going to be a win in their book. You know, stop the flawless map take.
Yeah, don't want to give over the 13-0. But that's certainly what North Alabama are looking for. And, well, it looks like it's going to be a pretty quick retake by the looks of things. That sheriff in hand is trying to spam down through the wall, but not really there. So now, still 5-on-5 as the push comes over towards mid.
Ooh. This is a little quick deke and deke, and that's going to be Atlantis goes hiding around the corner and grabbing one. Shotgun two to the face. Sushi calling it out like he sees it. Tonini on the back end with a very nice flank, grabbing one as well. That's going to force a difficult decision here in mid courtyard. They are getting routed as it is a 2-on-4. 2-4-on-1. Phoenix lost the fall as that is a clean 13-0. North Alabama taking the series 2-0.
Yeah, and and a clean 2-0 at that. And I have just heard that is the first 13-0 in NECC history ever. And honestly, well-deserved to North Alabama. Played incredibly. Squibb in particular, topping out the leaderboard 17-4. Gentrovert only died two times. Two times! I mean, that's just really strong. You really love to see that sort of play. And unfortunately for Upper Iowa, it's just going to have to be back to the drawing board. But like you said, lots to learn from this, from the VOD. Lots to learn to take advantage. And hey, if they come back and listen in, I think we had some pointers too. So definitely lots to take away from this other than just a loss. You can start to really ramp up as the season continues to move forward.
Yeah, and not only that, it takes time to build your fundamentals. It takes time to always practice your aim, always practice recoil control, right? These are the things that you can always be working on. So I'm excited to see if they can come back, maybe show some improvement near the end of this season. And I think that would be a redemption arc of sorts. But that is going to be it for us here on the desk for our second broadcast, but don't go anywhere. We do have a third and fourth match. I believe we have at 9 p.m. EST, Sacramento State Gold versus Midland coming to you live. So make sure to tune into that. But for the time being, we will go ahead and sign off for the intermission. My name is Orville. I was joined here with Vincent. Thank you so much for tuning in.